Taco Cat Goat Cheese Pizza. Very fun.
The cat and the pizza and the cheese. They're,
yeah.
And he came on.
Mark Holden.
Dressed as a clown.
Yeah, Mark Holden, yeah.
And I was terrified.
Arcade Blob?
So that was my best friend.
You! I'm coming for you! Yeah. Whoa!
Like solitaire on the fucking table.
Yeah, I was busy solitaire. I had a fucking great
time. I would jump back into this if I could do it with a friend.
Ellie's experiment. Ooh, that's cool.
Jesus Christ. She's still a fucking fourth grader.
She's programmed like that. She'll never age.
That makes it worse. Put it in the intro.
Is the Chop Top Australian?
Now,
like a
now,
gremlin.
Now I'm sitting there going.
Yeah.
It's Australian. Australia and New Zealand.
Good.
We're the only ones.
So it's a New Zealand thing that Australia has co-opted.
It's Australian. From the Lucas Studios, this is Wednesday, Thursday, the 15th of September, starring Stephanie Ben Dixon, Peter Byrne,
Thursday, baby,
Gus Ronald, Little Will, it's your boy Nick Boy Richardson, and tonight on the show, I'm feeling a little wayward tonight. I'm on edge, feeling dead, in a shadow of myself. Splatoon 3. Sometimes you just can't get it in there.
You can't get out of that valley.
You could have worked Splatoon in there, but it could have sounded dirty.
Yeah. And I was going for ennui.
And wholesome.
Yeah.
Splatoon was ennui.
Was it?
You.
Was it?
Were you?
Was it?
Were you?
Yeah, okay. Was it?
Yeah.
Okay, good.
We played the first Splatoon on that fucking giant pad.
It was on
Yeah, there
Wii
was some crossover with
that.
You're totally right. Yeah, no, that was actually a great joke. I have a feeling tonight could be a best show yet, but I'll just, particularly because, ladies and gentlemen, Pete, give me my close-up. I'm feeling particularly self-destructive tonight. I've taken some drugs that were not mine. I'm two scotches
keep doing that.
And three beers deep. So let's see what happens, Steph.
You want
to
get nuts?
I was going to say, are those like nipply things a little bit closer to your face than usual?
Mine? Wait, Gus's?
No, the sexy ones.
The sparkly ones?
Yeah.
He's kind of doing a jaunty lean.
Mm. Yeah.
Which I think is like, he's a bit like, hi-ho.
Regular Batman hides in the shadows and pops out. Nipple tassels Batman with the shirt off just leans in gingerly into the shot and goes like, I'm vengeance. Get him a little nipple.
Hey, oh my God. I just realized we could have created a new format here. You could live crash zoom to keep people's attention like a TikTok. That's how you could do the whole show.
I think that's what he's been trying to do, but he's only one man.
Nauseating.
No, he hasn't. He only does it at the beginning, but now
it's fucking awful.
What do you reckon, though, audience? Let's get a poll going. Let's get a little cheeky poll going.
He's not just self-destructive. He's going to destroy the show as well.
Gus.
Hi.
What do you want?
I was just going to say, if we choreographed it well, it would be amazing. You know what I mean? Like there are some one-liner moments where it would just be very like Arrested Development.
Well,
because it's like that crash zoomy kind of mockumentary style thing that would be awesome.
You're talking about jimming.
Pardon?
We're jimming the camera, Peter. If we're on our wide,
sir.
And then if you say something,
the fuck is that shot?
No, that's the one. That's the one, Pete. If you go from that, go to the wide, and then when Nick says something. Hang on, go to the wide. And then you say something controversial that the audience, and then...
Whatever Gus said about digital kids last week. That was agreeing.
Oh, I don't know. But it's jimming the camera. We're Jim from The Office.
You've got to do staple mouth. Mm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You gotta go like this.
There you go. Okay.
Peter?
Please stop, I'm getting dizzy. Peter? I see in chat.
Peter, you gotta... Nope. Wrong one. You gotta do this.
There it is.
Yep. I just want you to know that no one in the audience likes it.
Okay.
No one is a fan.
We're not having to go through it. It's their only. But
we should do it during
this segment. We aren't assuming each other as we're talking. We just get everything in our regular wide.
That's true.
They have to deal with however Pete chooses them to watch it.
Gus.
Nick.
Herbert Ronald. Why are we live early?
We are live early because we're going to watch the Tokyo Game Show Xbox Showcase. Is it? It's Xbox specific.
Yes.
But we're going to watch that.
I believe they're the only platform doing a showcase, fairly certain, affiliated with Tokyo Game Show.
Right.
Which is interesting because they sell like seven Xboxes a year.
I was just about to say, Xbox, not typically huge in Japan, but maybe that's why they're kind of making this push towards, you know, Tokyo Game Show. And
what have they got for us?
Their sort of celebration of all things.
Yeah, so that kicks off in 5 minutes?
Yeah.
So we're going to watch it. Yeah.
Oh, so we've got room for more crash zooms then, you're saying?
We do.
Like at least 5 minutes of crash zooms.
We don't, because we have to queue the segment.
Well, this is one of those things. Oh, do you want to queue the segment now or just before we go in?
I think we should be there when the clock hits zero, and it currently says 5.
Yeah, okay.
Unless there is a 20-minute pre-show, we do not know they're running.
Yeah, that's true. It could be.
It's back here for crash zooms for at least another 20 minutes.
You know how sometimes it's a timer and then there's another timer?
Well, then there's a panel, and the panel's talking about what they're looking forward to.
So am I like crazy? Because I always skip the pre-shows. Like, I'm so not interested in that. But the Ubisoft showcase that happened... Mm-hmm. Over the weekend.
That was a good pre-show.
Was it?
Yeah.
It was a decent pre-show.
The interesting thing about that, I think the whole thing was actually really solid. I was so impressed, Ubisoft taking a lot of heat, but I think they really nailed this one. Was the pre-show hosted by the same people who hosted the show? The attractive guy in the jacket and the girl?
No.
I think it...
Or did it cut back to them maybe going, only 10 minutes until where? Because I skipped through and I saw them.
There was the behind the scenes, behind the set shot, and then there was them on the kind of infinity set. But I can't
remember. Yeah, no, that's a good point. Yeah, I think they were just in a different set.
Yeah.
And the pre-show, they were just off the set.
How long?
20 minutes.
Yeah, like half an hour, I thought.
Oh, I thought it was longer. Right, okay. I thought it was like 2 hours, but maybe I'm totally wrong. But I was like, it's weird to have a pre-show hosted by the people who are hosting the show.
Yeah. That's just the show with vamping.
They could have asked you.
It was a more casual vibe. And it was a lot more kind of trailery sort of stuff. To me, like, I forget that there was stuff other than Assassin's Creed. It was such a chunky Assassin's Creed.
Mario and Rabbids? A bunch of other stuff.
Mario Assassin's plus Rabbids.
Yeah, yeah. Mario plus Rabbids.
No, we worked that out the other day. We're like, it's all the marketing. It was the first game, I assume, but it's Mario plus Rabbids.
Yeah. It's not Mario plus Olympics, isn't it? Mm. That must have been a Rabbids rider.
Yeah,
it's in their contract. We are. It's like the in a movie where let's say Emma Thompson is in this film, mm-hmm. and the credits start coming up.
The Rabbids movie.
Yeah, the Rabbids movie.
And
the credits. Yeah, and it's like, wait, hang on a second. We're getting to fucking whoever was one of the kids in Jojo Rabbit is now being listed before Emma Thompson, and then it's the end.
That's if you're a a well-respected actor, but you're not playing a major part.
Mm.
Then you're a with or an and.
Which is a rabid?
Which is what?
A rabid in this case?
Rabbids are with.
They're well-respected.
They're not well-respected.
But they're not the headliners.
They only do what? Addition.
They only do what?
Addition. Plus.
Okay.
It's there.
Will, did you get that?
What were you reading before, Will? Was it a Tom Holland magazine?
Thing. Hmm? I was hoping for the show would have started by now. But yeah, no, it's a fan book. Unofficial.
Unbelievable.
What? Unofficial? Tom Holland fan book?
Yeah.
How do they even get to publish those photos?
What is a fan book?
The craziest thing is they're all like official photos of the dude. Like,
hang on.
He's how do so they do that?
Where looking. Did you get this?
Wow.
What is this?
It was at Woolworths. I just saw this much of his head like poking over a thing. And I'm like, I wonder what that's
it
about.
It was at Woolworths.
Yeah. Can you bring it over here?
Yeah.
That looks specifically like something to take to a red carpet event to get signed.
It almost looks like a program at a musical or something. Like
Tom Holland the musical.
Is there information about where he likes to go on a date and what his favorite foods are?
There he is.
What's the quote?
Having this job is more than just having a job. Wait, where's he from?
England.
Yep. Having this job more than just having a job. There are kids looking at Spider-Man.
Nope.
I have a responsibility to be a role model. You were supposed to blow bloody doors off.
Oh, gosh.
Very good.
It's 1 minute 30 of Tom Holland quotes. Wait, in, folks.
Hang on a second. Oh, no. It's a picture of him upside down reading the Italy thing, but I thought he was reading his own unofficial fan.
That would be amazing.
That would be, that's a lost opportunity.
Yeah.
Was that like,
I'm so, I love
this. There's a minute. Should we go? There's some music and stuff.
Oh, yeah, sure.
I like the, I get it.
In a little segment we like to call... The Back Pocket Australia Time Zone Appropriate Tokyo Game Show Xbox Watch Party, brought to you by Middle C.
I would get an official, unofficial fan book for Middle C.
So would I. Well, I was trying to write Middle C's commercial yesterday.
Okay.
Ran out of time. Wrote 2 commercials, though. Keep that in mind.
Whoa.
I thought the
stream starting title just went to a minute and it just went into seconds and the clock, I was like, they put another hour on.
Lovely. They're running it forward.
But Middle C, I was trying to think of something, but I think I cracked it just before I had to go upstairs and pitch.
Little teaser?
Well, I think it could be a travel video.
Okay.
Ooh.
Yeah.
But I'm very excited about...
We're going to the middle of the Tasman.
The first one I wrote.
Yeah.
Yeah.
excited about all of them.
Yeah.
And the potential for them to have to be a nightmare to shoot.
Yeah.
Well, it's all yours, baby.
Yeah, that second one's going to be a real fucking pain.
You want, full screen?
Yeah. What the shit is happening? And they took the clock away entirely now.
Oh, they don't want to be limited to a specific second. They're gonna go live when they're ready.
How I think we should operate. Yeah,
it's with a lot of clocks. I mean, a lot of countdowns.
A lot of countdowns. Sorry,
clocks. I prefer when clocks tell me the actual.
Yeah.
Has he? Will?
Yeah.
Did he get a big old mole removed from his chin? As a
maybe.
Kid?
Did he?
Oh yeah, he's got a
yeah, well,
on his chin.
Oh shit.
Yeah.
When he was a kid.
Yeah.
I mean, it's in a pretty prominent spot.
It's a pretty the Spider-Man upside down kiss would have been totally different.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And also, he wasn't in that film.
I was about to say that was Tobey Maguire.
Yeah.
What's happened? Let me make sure that nothing's paused.
No, I can see things looping.
Yeah. I'll read more Tom Holland quotes,
please.
Oh, this is just every film.
Can you see things looping?
Yeah, I can see the background. The background circles are.
No.
Oh, wait, that's
Tokyo Game Show. Thing.
Oh, that's us.
That's us.
The background circles.
Tom Holland.
Shut up, Nicrotex.
Fame is a bit.
Refresh. Here we go.
There's another countdown.
Another countdown.
Are these hours or seconds?
He had your old hair.
Oh, yeah, he did too.
Here we go.
Starting with the trailer. Oh, we're going to. Whoa.
Shit.
15, 16, 18.
How
18,
old do I have 16. To be to watch this?
Peggy 12.
I don't think any of you expected this. You can play games on Steam? I love it. It's great.
What country is this again?
I don't know, but he just took some of Steph's drugs.
Xbox no fil des. Hello, everyone. It's an honor to be back at the Tokyo Game
Show.
That's
enough of that.
To share
it's all I can hold.
How would now just be God's American?
And to be able to meet with world-class Japanese developers in person this year is significant for us. The far-reaching power of gaming has always provided an important way to connect, but especially over the last few years.
I mean, a jacket.
Gaming brings people together.
No, 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 that's a dark gray for sure. He's not wearing black.
It has a transformative power to bring joy dark chocolate. And foster
community. Let's fight about it.
Well, Xbox's color is
TGS,
black?
Or is that we can all enjoy the incredible spirit of games together. I want to applaud the CESA organizers and supporters for TGS's
liked him,
which enables
a person who represents rampant capitalism
all of you
as much
have
as
built
this
TGS.
Guy.
Wow.
It was Steve Jobs and then him.
He just...
And whether you're attending virtually
he's got,
or
either
in person
got great PR or
message,
he just comes across as
we
very
we hope
relatable.
You enjoy the show.
I think it's a bit of both.
It is
Team
both.
Xbox's
we met him and
he was
going
to
he was such a lovely dude.
To bring the joy and community
but even if he was then
canceled,
having
the
met anyone, you're like,
we aspire
I feel like I met
to empower
them, so there's a little part of me that feels
play
like
games
I know a little bit more about them than everyone else.
They want anywhere they want.
He's great.
I know how he takes his
1.7 billion people in Asia play games.
I know he's had a cough.
Is it dark charcoal?
To learn and to create. That's over half the global gaming population. We are committed to listening to our fans here in Japan and across Asia.
Fan.
That Ben says that's black. Ben, toe the company line, mate.
Surely Reggie is in that territory. Yeah, totally.
Reggie's in that territory.
Reggie, for sure.
And building experiences that will delight players. This year,
we're just
we
saying
have
that opening sketch where there's six people in the audience. Is that a reference to how many people have Xboxes in Japan?
Probably.
Yeah.
We're incredibly thankful for everyone who has chosen to play with us. Xbox Cloud Gaming lets you play your games your way on practically any device. That
it's like
means
pitching Xbox to Japan.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, they're trying to
riding the train at work.
So as of July 2022, the PlayStation 5 has sold 1.5 million units
we're
in Japan,
also committed to
and the Xbox Series X sold 130,000 units, of which I'm sure most of them are expats living in Japan.
Yeah.
This generation,
how does that track with like the rest of the world? Because I feel like
than ever before
a lot of people are...
Largely because of Series S.
Playing a lot of Xbox
sales
stuff.
Series X to first-time Xbox owners. Players can enjoy great quality
Xbox
games
Series
across
is defeating
all genres,
PS5 in Europe,
including games on console, PC, or cloud.
Got it.
And new titles from Xbox Game Studios. And
he's got a tinge of red in
the same day they
that
launch.
I've never seen before.
That's the lighting.
Do you reckon it's just the lighting?
Look at his shoulders. It's the same flow.
Yeah.
We are
he's got a tinge of red in the shoulders that I've not noticed before.
For the next 20 years.
Get some of them red.
Is that just a reflection of his hair on his jacket?
It looks statuesque.
We've worked hard to make sure our games are available however you want.
Imagine
to
if this
play.
Was the whole thing.
Choice.
There's no announcements.
No games.
So Xbox is a gaming platform.
How to insert a disc into your console.
Everyone, Team Xbox, we wish you a great Tokyo.
He does
game
have
show.
A stance that looks like he's always
leaning
back
a bit.
Comfortably.
We
and assertively.
Well, he knows he's going to be captured by thousands of adoring
true.
Fans
he's
and millions
got, he's
of dollars.
He's got great posture.
Alice.
あなたの心を頂戴する。Persona?
Yeah. Fuck yes. I mean, we knew about this already, but still. Yeah. Very exciting. Very soon.
Oh, yeah, we did too. Just caught up in...
This was during E3. This was their E3.
Yeah. So are we going to see a lot of stuff repackaged?
I think there'll be a bit of that, yeah.
Yeah. Xbox is a very, like, Western-centric gaming company. I don't think they're going to have any big announcements. I'd love to see some Fable. I'd fucking love to see some.
Oh my god. Imagine if they were like, Japan is the country that we're really pitching Fable at. This game is so good. I can't wait to actually finish it.
Hello, Minge Maestro. Welcome to the chat.
What did they say?
They just did a little wavy.
They did a wavy hand.
And are you?
Because call me.
Wait, your tone? Hello, Minge Maestro.
Oh, Mylan's here. Hey, buddy.
I saw Mylan's post the other day where he reads one of the Destiny 2.
Oh, loud?
Well, it was all caps.
All caps?
Shouting, yeah, it was great.
That's so funny.
So October 21st, awesome.
Cool.
Good. I really want to play...
Four. Three.
Strikers.
Three was the one people...
Three was where it started. Three was good, four was great, five was excellent. I mean, four was good.
日本シリーズの今後の展開を考えていた際に戦国時代の日本ではない世界観で検討されて、私自身が三国志武将たちの物語が大好きだったこともあって、三国志武将ゲームというコンセプトで検討し始めました。中国の数千年の歴史に、ジャパニーズサムライゲームがアナウンスされた、プレイステーションのプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレイステーション2のプレ
Team
Ninja are doing Rise of Ronin.
Are they
making another Neo game?
But it's different spelling.
Yeah, it's Neo instead of...
It's not N-I-O-H.
It might be a regional thing, maybe?
Unless
Neo has a brother called Neo?
What are we watching? What game is this? I mean, this is the game. It's a new IP from Team Ninja says Full Metal Blitz.
Right, okay. So,
Neo Three Kingdoms, that's all I know.
It's saying Wolong Fallen Dynasty or Dynasty. They're all strapped with that, so.
Yeah. This is Wolong Fallen Dynasty. Right, okay. So none of the words that we had said previously until you just there.
お気に入りのキャラクターが死なないようにプレイすることも一つの大きなモチベーションになると思っています。
Yes.
The dev was just like, we want to give you good character customization because you won't want your character to die if you like the way they look. It's like, if I got a hot character,
they must live.
Yeah.
People deserve to see this space alive.
Yeah, 難易度それ自体が人気なのではなく、難関を乗り越えた時の達成感が他のジャンルやゲームではなかなか体験できない感情だからだと思っています
。
試行錯誤のプロセスが理不尽なものではなく、
I don't remember the first announcement. No, I do. It was a burning, like castle, and there was a dragon at the top, and he was fighting his way up there.
When was this?
That was the Xbox showcase. They showed it, but it was all pre-rendered. So this is the first gameplay I think we're seeing.
Lily Peppermint, you enjoy that show.
Every pair I've tried on at store.
You need
like a thinner face.
You look good with those serial killer glasses, like that size round.
Look good.
You know, like 70 serial killer.
Yeah.
Saying small round would pinch your face in with your tiny mouth and pinched eyes. Enormous forehead.
Well, you're the first of the And there was a dragon.
There it is.
Love dragon. That's sick.
Ooh. That gameplay actually looked fun. That looked
well. See, I love Neo. Neo 2 was great, and so I'm on board with if they continue down that path.
皆さん、お待たせしました。
This is an interesting Xbox design. It's blue, it's different font, it's squiggly. There's nothing.
It must be regional, yeah.
私もとても楽しみにしていました。今年のショーも皆さんに
I've seen the Microsoft Style Guide. That obeys every rule.
Yeah, they would have killed you if you had put that on something that we delivered.
世界各国の実力派スタジオより様々な作品の最新のゲーム映像とコンテンツが目白押しの特別なショーをご用意しました。
It does look like K-Box.
Oh my god, yeah.
Right. Does it or is it just the way that she's leaning?
Yeah, I think it might just be.
It's got to be the angle, right?
Yeah, no, I think it's just that she has boobs and that sometimes distorts.
I was going to say the curvature of the wearer.
The curvature.
The K-Box is to be looked at. That's exactly.
Yeah.
What the hell?
What does this say, Box?
Great green screen.
Exclusive footage of Exo Primal. Is this the massive thousands of raptors in the city? We saw.
Falling from the sky.
Yes.
Yeah.
Ibius won't own up to Leviathan's malfunction.
Can you address the reports of Exo Fighter Patrol on the island?
Yes. Look at this.
Exo Fighter Patrol is simply untrue. Ibius is committing all possible resources to the investigation.
Oh, exercise so results of... locked. Sunset PS2 temporal instance.
There was a series where you fought big ants all the time. I'm not wrong.
All the time.
What am I thinking of, chat?
Everyone's armed. Nobody knows what'll happen next.
Oh, I love all these characters.
Ant fighter game. 1 minute. EDF? Earth Defense Force?
Earth Defense Force. Thank you.
The next minute, they're shooting you in the back.
Yeah, cool hacker girl with an asymmetrical haircut.
Thanks, Crabrad.
Chat knows.
Crabrad knows.
The witness.
You need to keep violence.
Sorry, where are the rappers?
Destroy the violin. It's trying to build stronger exo suits, so it's pulling any extra fire in your home. Back to John and his bloody war games.
I remember the dinosaur puzzle.
That is such a...
But the more we use it...
Exosuits keep...
Yes!
Oh my god, Raptor Lemmings.
And she's British!
Valued team members.
Something in this game for all of us.
There are too many characters in this game, considering all you need to do is fight waves of raptors.
If there's a dating mode at the side of this, then we're all in. Everyone's taken care of.
Spinners!
Sick.
If you give an AI like Leviathan the directive, improve our actions. It this, has to complete you.
This whole story trailer has been about them in mechs fighting an AI. No one's mentioned why they're
dinosaurs yet.
Doesn't matter. Fuck. You don't. If a Did dinosaur rocks up on your doorstep, you don't ask why.
Did they come through those black portal thingies?
Must have been.
Yeah, it looks like.
There's always a portal to another dimension that lets dinosaurs in.
Whoa, was that a raptor with a helmet?
That would.
That why that was a secret.
Again,
reveal?
Hard to do a dramatic character reveal of a series that hasn't established itself yet. Be like, yeah. It's this guy. I can't wait to play that.
A dream crossover project. Oh, BlazBlue!
BlazBlue tag battle.
Fighters love the BlazBlue.
I'm just going to let the audience know right now that this showcase is really going to highlight our shortcomings in terms of some game knowledge.
Yeah, for sure.
I wish we had a fighting game fan here. I feel like it's a...
I don't, they're fucking horrible people.
That's true. That's true. No, he's right. He's right.
Have you met a good one?
It's like people who like anime, it's the same thing.
Yeah.
I did cover a fighting tournament once. And they're all nice people, but they were like, we walked around and no one wanted to talk to us. Everyone was there carrying their joystick around, being like, their gamepad, and being like, leave me the fuck alone. I'm competing.
But that's
like,
any competitive yeah. gaming environment. And people are like, I don't want to be interviewed.
Let's get weeby. Is it wrong that I want another Dead or Alive Extreme Beach Volleyball?
No, I think from in terms of a progressive standpoint, if it was made by a series of female devs, then we would that I because I saw a bunch of women on my timeline embracing the idea of bouncy breast physics and some stuff from the Ubisoft.
I'd play the volleyball mechanic, I'd play the fuck out of that game.
If it was all oily dudes, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Top
yeah.
Gun totally. Mansion.
But those yeah. pecs better bounce.
Oh yeah.
Did you guys ever see the movie, pecs. The live action movie with what's her face? Holly Valance?
Shit.
Holly Valance is in it, and she's in this amazing fight sequence where she's naked out of a shower, yeah. but like fights with a towel, and the towel looks always strategically flicked across everything. Like, it's one of those things where I was like, this is so awful, but also yeah. really very well done.
Did she marry a billionaire?
Yeah.
Yeah. yeah.
Someone candy.
Oh, this is
she's Holly Candy.
Hang on,
now.
This is great. We already know the smell of the game.
Guilty Gear Strive.
We already know the smell of the game.
This is the Softbox no communication manager, Reina Boranos desu. Honjitsu wa user no minasama ga machi nozonde
itta game no saishin
chouhou
wo osoru shimasu. That's Skyrim.
Oh.
Skyrim. I can't
oh my god, is Skyrim coming out again?
Skyrim! Trailers! In-game showcases!
Tango, thanks. Anniversary edition and upgrade.
Wow.
Did you?
Yeah,
45. Yeah. I knew you were going to ask. The Pit!
Coming to Fallout 76. Anyone here playing Fallout 76?
No.
I don't know why I asked the question. It would have been in what you've been playing.
I have it installed.
Do you?
Yeah, but I have not played.
Do you want to go to the Pit?
I played a bit of it.
Yeah, like a Pit.
It's new. Yeah, I mean, it's a Bethesda game. It will be 10 times better than it was when it came out now. There'll be a bunch of stuff.
This is cool. They're saying there's a localization for Redfall and in Korean as well. So it's like stuff that we just take for granted. It's like, that'll go global. It's like they need actual like, translations and versions of it that actually are just...
For sure, yeah.
Just assuming that it'll be in other regions.
Localization is a huge thing as well because it's not just about transferring the language or translating the language.
Oh, you're right.
But like, there's certain hand gestures and things that are super offensive in other countries that aren't here. So it's like, if this character does this in one scene, you're like, oh, we have to cut that out.
Rock a blade point.
This is the battle royale that you played out, right?
Yeah, yeah, melee VR.
You didn't mind it, but it's just
cool.
Your
thing. It didn't have Aussie servers, and it's totally not my thing. But it was like it was solid, and you know, your first couple of games you play AI, so you kick ass. So so I left it on the AI victory.
That's so
good. But it's cool. You got like you got tiered equipment like you do in most battle royales, but also ultimates in like a cool kind of fighting game kind
of. Yeah, the traversal movement was pretty cool.
Yeah.
Like when it wasn't.
Grappling hooky and
cool. So that's a wave mode? Run
Konnichiwa,
mode?
Mini-san.
Campaign
Etsu
mode.
Etsu Boxu no Sarah Des. I am thrilled to be here at
she
the Tokyo
that.
Game Show.
Sometimes you just have to
Japan
as an American.
Japan is truly a leader in the gaming industry.
Yeah. But and doing it with
many,
any kind of like
the heartbeat
proper...
of the gaming world. Here at Xbox,
now that's
we are
an outfit.
So grateful to include
what's
all
on that
of
jacket?
You
is it
in
just
our
a pen or is there a face?
Family.
Is it the IGN logo?
The IGN logo, yeah.
The IGN logo.
Creators here in Japan, and we listen.
That's cool as.
We are proud to partner with such visionary Japanese creators as Bandai Namco, Capcom, From Software, Kojima Productions, Koei Tecmo, Konami, Sega, and Square Enix. These masterminds have created some of the most revered and recognizable franchises in the world.
One day Australia will have one of these.
Partners of every
Xbox will be like,
size
we're just going to mention
every
all the Australian
genre
studios.
Are seeing success. We're
who
honored
have made...
that thousands of games are powered by Azure, and our Cold Azure land. Gaming business in Asia.
Little
Team Cherry.
Something beast.
Yeah.
Also, ID at Xbox,
monster?
Our industry-leading program for independent developers.
Give me the letters.
One of the games of the year.
Give me the two letters.
Japanese creators bring amazing and innovative experiences.
I see them on Twitter all the time.
Fans around the world.
Which
more than 250
you had
monster? Japanese creators are
monster.
Building
massive
for
monsters.
Xbox.
There you go.
These teams
massive
have monster already released more than 150 games, including Tetris Effect
great
Connected,
name.
Craftopia, RPG Time, The Legend of Wright, and The Good Life. Since we launched Game Pass in Japan in 2020 and PC Game Pass in Southeast Asia earlier this year, they keep evolving and getting better.
I wonder if they've seen, I don't know, I don't think they've released numbers. I wonder if they've seen a spike in Japanese players
today
with cloud, Xbox
games,
cloud stuff on phones.
Japan,
because
China,
it's
and
like
Korea, and
their console install is just not there, but yeah, the access of being able to.
Oh.
Will, what'd you press?
Nothing.
Are we still?
Ayuden Chronicle, 100 Heroes, right, and the Persona franchise. All coming to Game Pass.
But yeah,
we are committed
phones
to the Japanese market.
Yeah, totally.
And to
yeah
bring
yeah
a diverse
there, so that's
collection of
that's why they pushed it right. This is the first bit of vision that came up was Phil saying cloud Asia gaming, and then
yeah, right.
This
yeah,
is
yeah,
a
yeah,
vital
true
part of
yeah
our mission.
I think like we know you're not buying
it's
our thing.
Yeah, and everyone's got tiny
Japan
apartments as well. You can't fit a PlayStation 5
in,
and they've all got baller internet.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Remember when we went to Japan and they were like, "Oh, you go to the airport and they're like,
you
just carry this thing around and it's like 4,000 up, 4,000 down, just in your pocket all the time."
Go back. What's this called? Nino Kuni. But there was a sequel.
Which was not good.
Not great. Okay, this is that sequel. Well, actually, this is both of them. Yeah.
Yeah, cool.
Gorgeous music there.
That first game was great.
This
little Welsh voiced character.
Yeah, that's right. The king.
It's rare that you hear such a strong Welsh accent in a game.
I like
is it Michael Sheen?
Yeah, it was. Yeah.
Was it Michael Sheen?
Was it Michael Sheen?
No, it should have been.
Oh, right.
Oh, that's a chop.
That
was a massive job. Chobless.
Yes. This game is so beautiful, but just very repetitive. The first game.
The first one.
Very grindy.
Yeah,
but that's what people love, like this being a 120-hour, 200-hour game.
Yeah.
Like, sad. Like the start of it was really sad. It was kind of that had that whole escapism thing where it's like, is he actually in a fantasy world?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Running from his past.
It was the second one.
So part two's next year, and the first part's there now. Part two's already been out. In the
no,
world.
I mean, oh, that's what I think
yeah,
they
gotcha
said. Yeah.
So Spike Chunsoft.
Yes.
Danganronpa.
Yes.
Oh my God! They're so awful. Oh,
that's so good.
No.
You know I'm replaying the first one right now.
The design is, at its core, the design of that is fucked.
So
it just nothing works.
Game is so good.
Oh.
Will, have you played this game?
No.
I wish. Anyway, I've got to play this game. So fucking good, so good. This is everything I love about Japanese games.
What is it?
Everything. Sassless loves it. Chat, give me a one if you love Danganronpa.
There's so much happening.
Oh, this is,
there's so many styles.
Oh, it's crazy. You've never played it, have you? The courtroom scenes are wild, which is mainly what you're seeing here. The court battles.
I like consistent.
Yeah. No, thank you, Truffle Pig, for the sub.
Holy shit.
This is just one game as well. This isn't even a series.
Do what?
It.
Damn it.
Right.
Did you romp your Dengen?
You can do it right.
Overwatch.
There is a can I spoil the first death in Danganronpa?
Yeah, but
yeah,
just
man,
a sec.
I
is
won't.
This like
no,
a
yeah
hero?
Just give chat an opportunity to not listen. To
chat in five. I'm gonna spoil the result of the first class trial in the first Danganronpa in 5, 4, 3, 2, One. So the guy who kills the girl in the first murder is the baseball star, because all of them are like, they're the prodigy of something. He's the baseball prodigy, the ultimate baseball student. And the punishment that he gets is that he is tied to a stake in a baseball field, and the bear sets up a machine gun turret that shoots baseballs at him until he dies.
Nice. That's fair.
I mean, I don't need that in my life.
Girl on the bus.
This is just a new. This is a new Overwatch character.
This
character.
Announced, yeah. Or it leaked a week or so.
Yeah.
What current existing Overwatch?
Well, yeah. No.
Well, two. It has to be two.
Oh, yeah. But does it come to both?
But two isn't out yet, right?
Well, no. But
it's about to be. Like they're announcing the new
slate of characters. Yeah.
But at her core, I'm assuming she's a fully like Japanese character, both in like fighting style and everything cultural around her. She's cool.
Two is overtaken.
Yeah, something about the heart of.
But I couldn't remember if they were still bringing things
I'm
to one.
I'm pretty sure you can't even buy one anymore on its own. You can only buy two, and
so they're
one folded in with it.
I have replaced this information in my head. They're totally shutting down one. They're just pivoting to two entirely as a free-to-play game.
October 4th. I like the character. That was like a Ghostwire Tokyo character joined Overwatch.
Yeah.
Everything was the hands gestures and the white paper. And it's cool. I'm hoping I get into that Overwatch 2. I had such a fun time with
me
one when
too.
It launched. I really enjoyed it.
I think now that there's more options for characters that are not that give you more options to not be reliant on accuracy.
Well, some of the supports were so OP in the game.
I've never had more fun playing like a full like shield support or just like knowing that my job is not to push and just to get everyone in a position to do so.
Yeah, I'd really love to give it another go. I think I'm also just a little bit more confident now.
Yeah.
New Dawn.
Well, we saw Octopath 2 was announced as part of the Nintendo Direct the other day. But this has that same. This is what's happening with all these isometric sort of pixel art games.
This is the. How do I pronounce this? Iodin Chronicles?
Oh, is it?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
Is it, it's E I Y D U N, something like that. You know.
Oh, man.
So is this a new game or is this a remaster?
I don't know. Well, because I played.
Is it turn-based?
I'm not sure. I'm
Shark Man.
It's so not in my wheelhouse.
Yeah. Like. But that's like, what did I play recently? There was a remake that went from an original Nintendo game to this style. Alive, Alive.
Alive, Alive. Yeah.
Yeah.
Alive.
Which is like you could have been.
No, Live Alive.
Live Alive. Thank you. You could have been fooled for thinking it was a new game because they went so hard on this kind of. Awesome
I am meaning to check that out. The idea of like 40 to 130 minutes.
Very all game. Such slow starts.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. I would say play Octopath on mobile, dude.
Seriously.
Yeah? You'll fucking love it. You didn't see my
opera.
No,
opera comes out. Okay.
Look how excited you are. Do it on the way home. Download it right now, mate.
Think
it won't. Do the opera.
Follow fame, Nick. フォロー100英雄伝ライジングに登場した100英雄伝ではノアやセイ、シリサたちとともに戦う仲間になるのかも大きな楽しみの一つになると思います村山さんの描く群像劇にはいろいろな立場のキャラクターが登場してそれぞれの立場で行動してそれが絡み合って物語が紡がれているんですがここにはアクセサリー屋のスカーシュや防具屋のフリーダなど全く戦いに向いてないキャラクターも存在するんです
Hey, Nasty, you got a haircut.
I didn't, thanks for noticing that.
Doesn't look nice.
You're one of few who've noticed. I miss my own day. Yeah, it's cool. 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 Dark angle to come around on.
It is. It's hard.
Yeah, it's a hard.
And to not change the background.
Well, because they're already shooting on a pretty harsh angle for the main anyway.
I forgot.
で遊ぶ段階になって1プレイヤーとして遊ぶことで好きなキャラクターが出てくるんじゃないかなと思います。
Again, I still, I like that this style of game has found its look now.
作ってるとどのキャラクターも好きになるんですけど、最近はライジングをプレイしたので、
instead of going into just pixel art, a jump cut on the same green screen. What are we watching?
There's also some really like really big breasts. Like Chia was listening to the end of the question when it cut to her.
She's that size.
It's an odd edit.
これからゲームで出していこうかなというふうに思ってます。まあどんな形で出るかっていうのも
They should have caught us.
Should have called us.
We did that. We know we've got people in Japan. We did the Kojima thing.
That's true.
Cross the line as well.
No, no,
no, they're really mad.
No, no, no.
RPG っていうものはすごく開発に時間がかかるもので、
just adding shadows.
Yeah, it is. I mean, that's beautiful. Look at that. Give me that. Give me that.
So good.
Oh, that's so good.
And it almost looks cool that then when you see a close up of a sprite like that and having a tiny little bit of out of focus jaggedy, it's just like, I don't know what it is. Why is that better than having a properly rendered?
It's Dark Magus. Is her shirt inside out? This whole video went wrong.
The shirt.
That's a style choice.
Yeah, but the shirt is weird because it's got a normal collar and normal like open button part there. There's no fray other.
Oh yeah, no, that's right. That's right. Because buttons are on the opposite side. On women's shirts sometimes. But I was like, was it flipped? Was it inside out? What just happened? Factoroid or whatever? Style game?
This is... oh no. Wait, is it?
just give it another beat before something else weird rocks up and you're like...
Yeah, it's Dyson Sphere program, yeah. I think... Who was it? SithCat gifted me this game.
Oh, really?
I haven't started it yet.
When did it come out?
Give me games, which is so nice.
Yeah.
I like that. It came out nearly a year ago.
The camera language used was a choice. As well as it has. While this is playing, I've got a very short little Forza story.
Please.
On the weekend, I drove through the Hunter Valley winery.
You didn't come and say hi?
No.
Okay.
But I put on the playlist. I put on the playlist from Forza Horizon 1. Mm-hmm. It was 1, or no, 2, when you drove through wineries in Italy.
Yep.
And I drove through.
Beautiful.
And I had one of those real moments of blurring of worlds. Driving over hills, listening to opera, and like every other car coming around felt like a driver tar. It was wild.
That's so funny.
Oh, yeah. Pokemon knockoff?
Yeah.
Temtem?
I saw a lot of.
Is this Temtem?
I don't know if it is.
This is Temtem. This is Plugger Blurbo. It's got
a gun. Scammer.
It's
Pal World.
That's it.
This is the one that they showed.
This is
before.
Pre-rendered.
They've been pushing this pretty hard.
This is not gameplay.
I mean, this is on the same level to me as the Avatar mobile game.
This is a mobile ad.
What are you doing?
Yeah.
Why did you give weapons to these beautiful nature?
Because it's the funniest trailers ever, man.
Oh my
like,
gosh.
Holy shit. It was the sweetest talk. Big, like, Nessie character.
Yeah, and it panned down. That was when I gave guns to Sweetheart in No Man's Sky.
Do you need to reload that animal? Or is it Tobey Maguire's Spider-Man where he creates the web himself?
Oh, and you make the mine. You can list them to
Yeah, send them to the mines.
The music is so happy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But all the animals...
These are just straight up, like, these are so close to Pokemon.
Yeah. I wonder what... They must have a good Guri-Guri team.
They're all your pals.
Guri-Guri team.
Yeah. Now give them guns. Holy shit.
What's this guy?
Dolphin pants. Look, this is pretty fucking sick.
Let's not kid ourselves.
Yeah, exactly. Is it Assassin's Creed?
Yeah. But no. The Assassin's Creed from, like, 4 years ago.
Odyssey.
Yeah.
Embrace this journey, my child.
I played the first 3 hours of this recently, hadn't touched it. It is maybe.
Did you play,
this one's great.
Did you play
it's so good.
Did you play as Cassandra or the other guy?
Cassandra, yeah.
everyone
she's
says
she's wonderful.
Like, most of the time, people are like, "Oh, the characters are pretty comparable," but everyone says Cassandra's so much better than the other character.
This is so weird that we're watching a trailer for Assassin's Creed Odyssey, and now they're talking about it coming out on like Game Pass. Like, I don't know. It's just,
yeah.
I mean, it's cool.
What world are we in?
Yeah, it's like, what year is it?
Yeah. Think of the audience are watching us watch. It. That's even weirder. What's wrong with you all?
Do you remember, it's like when, do you remember movies used to come out like heaps later here than they did in the States?
Yeah.
Like heaps.
Yeah, like months.
Yeah.
Which is so weird to think about.
Yeah.
All the time they come out earlier because we're ahead now.
Yeah.
Wait, should we get them before then?
Yeah.
Highlight still is Waterfall of Raptors over here.
Yeah, Waterfall of Raptors.
Dune was a 1 month delay. I think that was a COVID-related thing,
though. That was a COVID thing, yeah.
It came out in July?
Yeah, but like, but our cinemas took longer to open.
Fugger. Oh, I've heard about this. I've heard about that game. That's the fur. It's like furry. It's furry.
World War.
Yeah.
Watership Down.
Yeah. What was that? What was that war game?
Watership
with
Down was already pretty fair.
What was, what was the war game with the war game with the beautiful art style?
Oh, there's a sequel announced.
Yeah,
Valiant Hearts.
Valiant Hearts.
Valiant. Yeah, Valiant Hearts. I think it's like furry Valiant Hearts. Yeah.
Yeah, nice. Finally, the game that Xbox own is coming to Xbox.
Yeah, that's so true.
And a reminder how excellent this game looks for that HUD. It was a pretty HUD-heavy game.
Get him.
Had a lot of fun in this game. But all of their games look great without a HUD. And then you play it and pray it's like...
Man, I want to play it with the Japanese dub. That was
yeah,
that was sick.
Although the voice... His voice was fucking...
He was amazing.
Yeah, the ending sucks. The end, Green Tornadoes, the ending was a giant...
I'm so glad I got the game pod this one. I fucking love it.
I had a ball.
And I wouldn't have persisted if I was training.
Definitely a super cool console.
I know, I realize that I'm very much drawn to, it's the same with, like, it's like Sifu. I'm very much drawn to games where it's like, there is a sandbox puzzle here that you need to figure out the optimal way to do this run. Like, it's almost run-based stuff, but like, in open worldy, whatever. Like, I really love that kind of game.
Yeah.
Yeah, but didn't we talk about when we talked about the best thing about this game was that it didn't have that, like, let me go back and do it again. It was like, every time I fucked up, I had fun in this.
Totally, yeah.
Like, it didn't 100%. Make me go, like, I got it wrong, I could have done that better. My adaptive play style was the adventure in this, not the, like, I know what I did wrong. Is there anything new? That's
yeah, it looks like there's some new weapons and a couple of new things on the map.
So
yeah, it's so stylish, isn't it?
Fucking Japanese love mixing like a slightly more obtuse song choice with their like game style. So funk and jazz and all this stuff is like perfectly worked. Yeah, what the fuck?
Is that That's right, because that came out like just after the acquisition announcement.
Yeah. It had been announced for as a PlayStation exclusive
before the thing, and then it was like, it
so what's
came
happening
out
with Deathloop? Yeah, it's like, well, they're honoring that.
Yeah,
that's right. I remember that. That's right.
We are thrilled to finally bring our labor of love, Deathloop, to the Xbox Series S and X.
Is this the guy who did
players
a couple of the
trailers?
Yeah, the press stuff.
That the secret all this time.
And they were like, okay, we've got this game coming out. Yes, that's going to work.
Yeah, because I think the game director, and it was very much like, all right, well, you came up with this. It's your job to put out four trailers explaining how to play.
And it's doing it again.
And people didn't, and you still didn't understand it until you started playing.
The mysteries of the island of Black Reef and its dangerous denizens.
Thank you, Dangling, for the sub. 14 months.
One loop at a time.
I can only hope that we maintain Minj Maestro for that long.
My pocket automatically goes, you're stuck here forever. I love that.
It includes Minj Maestro, if you're still here, Chuck Submate. Launch,
including accessibility options. Chuck is a sub Minj Maestro.
Will someone gift Maestro?
Because he's, God knows, he or she are doing the Lord's work for at least half the population.
New upgrades, an extended ending, cross-platform matchmaking,
often with tied to something musical, right? Isn't
right
it?
Now,
it's to be a like a,
really
a maestro is like yeah, but in the terms, it's like you're a maestro,
you
you're an artist, like
yeah,
at the top of your game.
I,
no, I know yeah. that, but again, even then, wasn't often used.
Yeah, definitely music,
predominantly in music.
Yeah,
yeah,
but you know, maybe he's got a little bow. Like a little violin bow that's down there.
There you go.
I'm, extended more, ending? Is that what just got announced?
I thought more,
We're talking about Minch Maestro.
No, but extended ending to, the, you know, the thing that we're meant to be doing.
Oh, shit.
And the thing we just talked about, how the ending...
The ending was so fun. Yeah.
That's cool. If that's real.
It's the K-Box play.
I wonder... Oh, wouldn't it be great if it worked on an existing save?
Wow.
I'm sure it would happen.
But the ending has not changed. It's extended. So the ending that you would have already seen would still exist.
I like that, though. Instead of fixing an ending, like, by redoing it, just add more.
That is, no, it is true that I wasn't necessarily dissatisfied with the story. It was just how abruptly it all sort of, like, came to a head.
Yeah.
Oh, this is a big, like, here's everything else coming as well.
Nakjess gifted the T1 sub to Mint. Nice.
Ghost.
Hey.
You've gifted 204 subs in the channel.
Oh, it's Minge Maester.
Oh, Maester.
Oh,
that's different.
I read Maester when I first.
That's different.
Yeah,
that's
up.
Tens to the Minge.
Cool.
Yeah. Majority.
This is a real confusing one because majority of these will be out. This is just kind of saying here's everything else you're getting on Game Pass, with the, but this is with the Japanese Game Pass, so we might not be getting them all.
Does Game Pass work regionally like that?
Was it a different person and there's another Minge?
Oh, that would be incredible.
That would be amazing. Microtex has got
That's
a Minge.
Not the same person.
There are two.
There can't be.
There can be only one Minge Maestro.
Can't be true.
So funny.
And the stupid way that they've changed the Twitch thing is you can't see all viewers, it's just some active viewers.
Protect the lurkers.
Yeah. Tech, God bless them.
It.
Is that it?
I think
is
that's it.
Huh. Are we damned?
You guys were hoping for Zelda.
Zelda?
Zelda on the Microsoft.
I mean, what kind
I
of world?
Feel like anytime I feel like anytime we watch anything that comes out of Japan, it's like, is it going to be Zelda?
Well, I mean, they did come out beforehand and say, this is aimed at our Japanese
audience. Totally. I found that actually really interesting.
It is. I do like seeing when things are marketed differently for different regions.
Yeah.
Like, what is it about a Japanese audience what is it about that stuff that a Japanese audience appeals to rather than like a Western trailer?
I don't know.
For
did you see the Danganronpa trailer?
Yeah, and I guess the way you package it too is important because if people are used to seeing things in a certain way, you can't kind of like throw something random at them and be like, "This is how we normally do our press conferences," and you got to watch it this way.
Yeah.
So remind me, we did see snuck in there Skyrim.
We will
that was a little
we will get that be conference. 84 years old and we'll be seeing trailers for Skyrim. It'll be like anniversary edition re-release.
Yeah. Unbelievable.
On your watch.
I know that we just watched the Xbox one, but should we I just wanted to quickly say did we watch the PlayStation one?
Yep.
Yeah. Yep.
Where there wasn't necessarily a ton, but that God of War trailer. I know that I am like the biggest God of War stan in the room, but I certainly like I never had any doubt that this game will be amazing. But
I thought you were cool. I thought you were like not
no, finished. That was
temperature
it.
Temperature cool on God of War. I thought that was you.
No, that was him.
No, he
that was
freaking
you.
Out.
He didn't
Your
like
husband.
It at all. Mm. Yeah. No, I loved it. Some of the gameplay and stuff that we'd seen over the last month or so when they started showing some things, they put out a longer gameplay clip and it was like, this looks like it could have just been cut out
first
of the first game. And like,
yeah.
It,
yeah.
But that trailer that they showed at the thing was so good.
A lot of variety.
Yeah, like
a lot
so
of
much
Blades
variety.
A lot of chaos, a lot of OG God of War style, like hardcore combat. And
so much scale, like such an epic, like there's a point where they like shoot the bow and tear
that
the
was fucking
world
beautiful.
Apart, which was incredible. The line which made me so excited for this is he gets knocked off in the trailer off the cliff and he dangles off there and he's like, death can have me when it earns when it me. Earns and me. It's like, fuck me. Come on. That was such a great line.
It was very bad.
I have a picture of that line in my phone. Really? As inspiration for when I'm feeling down.
Yeah, it's been crazy. There's been so much announced in the last like week or even like sort of 72 hours. But the Nintendo Direct was out as well, which didn't have too much stuff, but it had a little bit of Zelda at the end, which I was really excited for. I was pumped for that. Maybe not in the same energy of God of War, but I was adequately like, okay, I'm pumped for that. May the 12th next year or something like that. Looks cool.
And we saw the PSVR 2 stuff. I saw an extended demo of that, hands-on from IGN on that. Apparently the screen quality is really good.
It's the best resolution of any headset available.
Yeah, any commercial cool. or...
Yeah, commercial yeah, one yeah. that's maybe not a like early access.
They'd fixed the cable situation better.
It's one cable. It's one. It's a single,
that was always a massive barrier.
It's a single cable headset in what is becoming an environment of people saying like, no cables is the best version of VR. So I'm curious to see. It does feel like VR has had its extra little boost of, you know, the Quest 2 and that kind of stuff, or the Meta Quest 2 or whatever. And now it's like, I don't have any strong appeal to go back into the world of VR. And there's like one launch title being
Horizon. Yeah, I was going to say, the stuff that they showed off, there was the Horizon thing, but there was like, I've got the list here. There was like Star Wars Galaxy Edge.
Walking Dead. Already out, right? It's like
Demio, like stuff where I was like, I kind of know all this already. Yeah.
Mm. Yeah.
Which is a bit of disappointment. And then the last thing was Tekken 8 as well. That trailer was like, again, I don't really care about fighting games, but it was just like every time someone got knocked down, it was like they charged up their muscles more. Got stronger.
Doesn't that
happen to you? Sorry?
Doesn't that happen to you?
I never get knocked down, mate.
I feel like Tekken has gone through phases of just being like, oh, we want to try and make it more realistic. And they're like, no, that's not for us. We need to like make our legs more trunkier.
I read a tweet or something recently, and maybe you read it to me, that was like, you know, there's a character that's head is a... panther in Tekken.
Yeah.
And
there's
like
a character that's all made of actual tree logs.
No, I remember that, but someone told me that the character whose king. Head is a king is actually wearing is a man with a mask, or was a lion that was controversial.
Was it King
Louis? Do you know what I'm talking about?
I think is not an actual tiger person.
Yeah.
Oh,
it's like they've maybe retroactively decided to change that character's lore.
Yeah,
it pissed a lot of people off.
Yeah, which is a bit weird. And then also there's a PlayStation exclusive quest for Hogwarts Legacy, as if that game needed weird talking point around it.
Yeah,
it was like, oh my god, like remember PlayStation and like console specific quest lines that you could
it better be one hell of a quest.
I missed
buy a store and open
I missed the concept of exclusivity there, and I was like, what is this, like some, why are they showing like the DLC for this game?
When it's not
the quest is it? You pre-order a wand, but you have to wait an extra 8 months for it to arrive because they're out of stock.
Is that a reference to the fact that the PlayStation was late?
Oh, okay. Yeah, good. Haunted Hogsmeade shop is
my hair was my source of humor.
Sorry, and the
Samson and the funny bone.
And then the last thing was the Pikmin 4. We saw a little bit of Pikmin 4 in the Nintendo Direct, and I was like, Tinykin shits all over this already. Yep. Like, it looks so ugly. It's so drab.
So slow.
Like,
such
unappealing character design with the Pikmins and stuff. And Tinykin, again, I played another level with... That's what I said, Tinykin.
You sound like you're saying King.
No, I know what I'm saying.
3 weeks
ago. So I played another level with Banjo, the bathroom one. And it was just like, I mean, he...
Start that bathroom
party. He is in love with this game. He cannot get... And you have to start playing games with kids, particularly these sort of puzzle platformers, because their memory is like a steel trap. Mm. We play for an hour, and towards the end of the thing, he was like, that goes at the thing in the other... And I'm like... I don't even remember your name, let alone like where we were an hour ago.
Incredible. A tiny king.
Do you ever think about the fact that like you're shaping the kind of formative early memories of his gaming life?
100%. It's going to be Tinykin and then Danganronpa. big time. Yeah, totally.
Because you, when you're a kid and everything is a marvel, like it's exciting to think that he's going to have memories of the games that you guys played together, and that's always going to stay with him.
I mean,
and why is he dying like this? Because he was a baseball player.
Mm-hmm. Yes, he was. I mean, it is like one of the greatest things about having children is the fact that you know that you're sort of shaping memories that will be meaningful to them one day. But I never had a parent that loved me. No, I'm kidding. Dad's probably watching right now. I never had a parent that was into video games because most of us didn't really. Mm. And so, yeah, it's a totally different thing now of like taking a child on a gaming journey. Yeah.
And curating their taste in gaming as well. Like, this is what you're going to love.
It's not about putting you in a mech. Okay, cool. We're going to be back after this very short break with more Back Pocket.
Guys I was getting matched with on most dating apps were just not right. Like, these were bad men. So now, after every awful date I have, I just tell them to join Allwood.
From parent IT company Isaac, Allwood is the dating app for the modern woman who's sick of being matched with assholes. Here's how it works. Men join thinking it will be an easy way to hook up, but what they don't realize is there are no women here. Allwood is just dicks. Now, these guys will only get matched with people who share their interests. Interests like lying in their profile bios, not calling you back after the first date, and actually being married with kids. Let's hear from some of our unsatisfied customers. Don Juan DeFucco asks, where do ladies at? Biker Balls wants to know, why do I keep getting matched with jacked dudes who send me pictures of their dicks? And Sisyphean Penis has the self-awareness to ask, is this some sort of ironic Grecian myth punishment? Allwood. There are no women for you to harass here. It's just Allwood.
I think it's Steph's turn for the credits.
Okay, ready, Steph?
Yes. Scotty Feeders, Bit Nano, Super Studios, Scotty Wrangling by Toxichog does something, Wolsey, Steph Attention Grabber, someone. Steam Faggot, and Kickalululade. Kaylee Cohen, I know that one. Loki Cat is the bird dispenser supervisor.
The bird dispenser.
Well, maybe I can demo loop burping.
Oh no!
Can you do that?
Sing me a song of the Belgian man, purple way, and put me down as a Belgian fan, purple way. Cause the man can belch and the man can burp, bark and bray and cheep and chirp, even though his friends all call him a twerp, he'll purple way.
So it's just like pulling air in and then forcing it back out.
If I do it, am I going to throw up?
A little bit.
The pressure of the close-up.
So good.
Man's genius.
Yeah.
So good.
Me?
Talking about you.
Yeah.
Can Musa for Hire be involved in Back Pocket talent show?
Yeah, do something live. Okay, Musa for Hire, do the
medley, beer in my crotch.
No, what was the name of the thing? The guys, you know, Triple J, the 90s, early 2000s.
Oh, Umbilical Brothers.
Tripod.
You know, the song in an hour thing.
Oh, yeah.
We start off with something at the beginning of the show, and by the end of the show, he's made a song. I don't know if it can work that far.
Spent like a week stressing over that.
I'm not at PAX.
Piece of music. Do not make them do it in an hour.
Should have given him the fucking ticket.
Oh, Blob.
God damn it, Blob.
Blob.
Give him the ticket.
Speaking of, just for the talent show.
Malachi Frost, by the way, your talent thing is under assessment right now from the Victorian government in the state police. Fantastic. Musifier. Musifier also helped me out with a musical question that I asked on Twitter yesterday, and that was very helpful.
Lovely.
Yeah, just lovely. A good human being overall.
As long as they help you, that's the criteria for being a good person.
Someone that assists you in some way.
Peek in my closet.
Now he's going to gym the camera.
Yes. Okay. Before we get to our next segment, speaking of people who help us, let's go a little someone who helps us.
What? Build PCs.
Oh, you just looked like you were going to say something.
No, I was like,
build PCs. It's Dream PC. Oh, my goodness. If you could dream it, they can build it. Easy to configure their PCs via their website. They've got a website. It's not...
What the hell?
It's not 1986 anymore. You can go on the internet and buy these things.
Oh, yeah.
Bespoke systems built to order, authorized Australian market parts seller, live updates via their build tracker. But the most important thing is that they are decent human beings.
Because they help us.
Yeah. Because so therefore you're nice. No, because I think we spend a lot of time talking about Dream PC and the weird nipple PCs that you could build out of the different human
that
parts.
That was one time.
That was last week.
Yeah, but
that,
yeah.
That every sticks. Yeah.
Toxic Troll sure just does. Bought a PC from them. Did you buy the nipple PC, Toxic
Yeah,
Troll?
Did you get a skin flesh one?
Yeah.
Fantastic. Toxic Troll, thank you so much for buying the thing. But Rick, we talk to Rick pretty often from Dream PC, and he's just a lovely human being. And I just feel like I wanted to say, you know, I should talk a lot of the sponsors on here. Your Burry Burries, your Loki Cats, all the other idiots. And I just want to say, Rick, you're a decent dude.
Now,
decent.
You need to
could be better.
Make up for that by shit-talking him because he's going to feel like he's not a part
he's going to
expect
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
He's like,
do you know what happened?
Tell me.
I went to that restaurant in the city. It's called Karen's Diner. And the premise it's full of Karens who are just really rude to you. And so... you know, the shtick is that you turn up and they're like, what are you doing here? And they're like, you know, giving you shit and just insulting you and stuff like that. And they take you to your table and they're like, ugh, when they have to take your order and everything like that.
How
long does that last?
So I went, well, yeah, I mean, it's...
not long, clearly.
I loved it.
I did go there with Peter, but I went there with a group of friends
yeah.
before I went with Peter.
You went
and
back?
Yes.
Not by choice. Circumstantial.
Not by choice. It was circumstantial. But when I turned up, they were there. They yelled at all my friends. And then the dude behind the counter looked at me and was like, oh, my God. And I was like, and they were like, you're amazing. I used to watch you on television when I was a kid. And I'm like, and they're like, go sit down. And I'm like, come on!
You're my character! The only reason I'm here! The food is terrible!
And they would come to the table and be like, you're all shit! Not you, you're perfect. And I was like, I mean, thank you, but come on!
That's why you went back, isn't it?
What is it like as an experience? Like, is it just...
it's pretty average.
Yeah,
it's pretty average. Yeah.
I have the staff were wonderful. Awesome. They were lovely and amazing. All, like, actors.
Yeah, yeah, just, yeah.
You know, as a side job.
And they played the roles pretty well.
They did.
They leaned into it.
But the food is not great?
The food is average, and like we sat under a table under a speaker that
under
was just
table.
Fucking way too loud.
Yeah, right. Yeah. I would say the worst thing about it was that they're trying to sort of fill time in between people's sort of rude waiter experience because they're trying to create an experience
with
games, and they just had this really like peaky, awful PA system where they were just like screaming stuff into
it.
Does that play into it, though?
They're like, it was actually physically
painful. Like, it was that loud.
Okay, yeah,
it was audience participation stuff that you could only kind of half make out.
That sucks.
It was not great.
Maybe Dream PC could offer a negging solution for people who like ordering their PCs but with like a negative attitude.
Oh yeah.
So every email you get back and forth is like
A little negative message in your PC.
Yeah.
Like a sort of really expensive, depressing fortune cookie.
Yeah. It's like you buy a 3080 and it goes, you're still gonna fucking suck at the shooter you want to play.
Yeah. Or a better one is coming out in 2 months.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure, like, because my CPU cooler has a little LCD screen on it that you can program stuff onto. So you could do that.
Dream PC, if there's a way that we could organize that we just get to write a bunch of insults that get sent out to all your customers, like one a day that gets sent out to their CPUs, that would be amazing. That would be
one
so
a day.
Good. Well, I'm not going to sit there and insult. That's a full-time
job. I love the implication that every PC, the Dream PC build, they're still remote accessing at any given moment.
That's a Dream PC guarantee. All right, time for our next segment, a little something we like to call... Saying what y'all been playing, presented by another good human being, Burry Burry. Burry Burry is a
builds PC
lovely person, and this is not physically hard to say at all.
I feel like you have all of the excitement in your head of the thing that you wrote, and you don't want to give any of it away.
It's actually true. It's actually
that was the first thing I thought.
Yeah.
As soon as you start saying Burry Burry, I'm like, oh, I have all this extra information in my head that we can't now reveal because I feel like we've been working on a thing. And now it's like, oh, what do we say?
I am very excited for that. We really got to figure out how to pull that off.
It has potential in script form, in actual production and shooting form and editing.
Even better.
Yeah, we can make that work.
We can make it work.
It's going to be awesome.
It'll be fine. But until then, we'll just need to settle for some game talk. Gus, start us off with what you've been playing this week.
Easy. Yeah. I've been playing a ton of Splatoon 3. I am a fan of this series. That's no surprise. I've been a fan since I first was an inkling. Squid Kid. The lore of this game is crazy.
Inkling. I love Squid Kid. I think
you're a Squid Kid, but you're an Inkling. But now I'm an Octoling in this one because you can be both. And there was previously like, do you want to be an Octoling or a Squid?
More inclusive.
It is. Well, I think the Octolings were meant to be the baddies in the single player. Anyway, there's a new Splatoon, and I think a lot of people would be like, well, what's new in a game that has pretty much got their formula down pat?
I have one question.
Shoot.
What's new in a game that has pretty much got its formula down pat?
Peter Burns, sit tight, because I'm going to tell you. I think this game has done a really good job. I'm fucking throwing, I don't know where to go.
Sorry. It takes a lot for you to admit that.
It is more of the same here, but it's just perfecting a formula, which, being the third game in the series, it is just really ironing out any of the sort of kinks or creases that the series has had previously while bolting on everything that's worked about it. I think the word to describe this game is value. There is so much to do, and there's in terms of these other game modes that exist within this title, it is a really hard game to put down because it is essentially four games in one, which I know sounds like a reason to be like, it's doing four things not that well, but it's doing all of them really well, which is obviously what you're seeing here is the competitive, turf war, the traditional just PvP, 4v4, and just trying to ink a whole area and enjoy it. But then beyond that, if we scrub a little bit further forward, there's the single player, which has been in the previous games, but here is just like fantastic. Mm-hmm. I feel like they've really got this one down pat because they've built on what worked in Splatoon 2, specifically the expansion to Splatoon 2 that was the Octoling expansion, which was this awesome, just all these mini arenas that all have clever little Nintendo ideas baked within them, and a stupid story and wacky worlds and silly characters. And I should hate it. I should hate how just batshit crazy and everything's just nothing makes sense, but it is really delightful.
Like structure and order.
Yeah, I do. And
consistency.
Exactly. And there's nothing consistent about the Splatoon world, but the single player is great. They've opened it up in a way that, Nick, I know you've played a little bit of the single player. There's a bait and switch at the start. They're like, here's the same single player you've played before. Here's the same boss you've run into twice before. Mm. And you do that for about half an hour, and then it goes, you know what? No, we're sending you to a different area. There's a new boss. There's a new way in which you access all these areas. There's a currency system, an RPG system.
I think the purpose of that is to kind of trick people into thinking they're not getting anything new.
It's just been them being cheeky, it feels like.
Is it to make you feel more excited by the new thing by setting it up?
Could be.
Setting you up to feel like you're not going to get anything new?
I mean, yeah. Whatever it is, it works.
It's well, because like, the first half hour also kind of acts as a tutorial. Really. Yeah, like, it's a super, like...
And well, so it's like, well, you're familiarizing...
Reminding people of what they're
familiar with. Yeah. And, like, in a nutshell, it's essentially this. It's the, like, the mammalian is the sort of hook, which is this big brown fuzz, which is infected an area. Your job is to move through all these little islands doing little standalone levels, but you progress by throwing your little buddy, a salmonoid, to clear these areas and choose which direction you go, and it actually branches out really sparsely. Like, you can go in all different directions.
Sparsely?
Like, it spreads out well. Okay. Sparsely is not the right word, you're right. Just sort of, there's a lot of choice in terms of, you don't get, it's not giving the illusion of choice and then just being like, do these eight levels in a row.
Right.
From what I've experienced in the first like 2.5 hours of it, it's
So this is a hub and that's a level down that
tube. That's a level, but then you can be like, nah, fuck that, I'm gonna go and choose a different one, or I'm gonna actually spend all my currency on getting into the next island, which is more difficult.
Oh wow.
But I don't have the power.
So it's quite big.
Yeah, it's huge. And then there's like the boss fights are for the first time really hard if you haven't leveled yourself up. Mm. So you can kind of fast track your way to the further down the single player progression, being underpowered, which is kind of complex for a game that I thought wouldn't have it.
So I haven't played too much at all.
Yep.
I've enjoyed what I've played so far. But when you say underpowered, is it, you mentioned the RPG thing, is it like stat stuff or you're getting better weapons?
Stat stuff. Yep. Because the main weapon thing is that, the main weapon thing they've got is you can do these little stages and you can use the default weapon and you'll earn this much currency, or you can use a more complex weapon sometimes that's harder to play the level with, but you'll earn more currency.
Ah.
So there's a little risk and reward. There's a little RPG element in there that, like, opens up in a fun way that is gives you a lot of choice in that way that campaign runs, which is totally unnecessary because the core game of the multiplayer in this is great and doesn't need a single player game. But no, it is really fun. I'll keep blasting through it because then if you skip forward a little further forward, well, there's of course the Salmon Run, which is the wave mode that was introduced in Splatoon 2, which was my favorite thing in the series.
Came and went?
No, it existed in 2, but it had that thing where it was like, it was timed, so you could only play the level.
That's what I meant,
No, during the week,
there
was only certain hours that Salmon Run was open that you could go and run it. It was controversial and people were just confused by it. It was like, you might boot the game up at 8 in the morning and it would say Salmon Run's not available right now, it'll be available at 6 tonight.
What was that? Why?
I think it was to keep the player base there, like everyone would be playing that at the same time, so there were enough people. It's cooperative, so you're playing with three other people to complete the level, and it's pretty hard to do without a full player base, so I don't know. People were questioning what that was about, but now it is available around the clock, and it is the same Salmon Run. You're collecting gold eggs, you're getting all these salmonoid bosses, and it gets hard really quickly, and it can be a cakewalk or it can be really hard on the first wave.
It's Salmon Row eggs that you're collecting.
And there's a whole gear progression system using that as well, but it is just as fun. I know a lot of people were like, that's my main Splatoon thing from 2. They were like, Salmon Run is the best version of the game, I love this, I hate the competitive. And I was one of those people. I really enjoyed it.
Can you party up with friends and do it?
Yeah, cool. And same with Turf War now, something you couldn't really do well in 2, which is like you can make a party of 4 and you can keep running through multiplayer together and not drop out of Party Connect, all that kind of stuff. Some of the basics that Nintendo has always struggled to get working has been sort of, again, little quality of life things.
Very quickly, I did see Peyton in chat say, I don't know, or like, how do you play this game? I don't understand what it is. For some people who may not have played Splatoon top level, it's basically like a paintball war where you're either side, you're trying to cover as much of the map as possible with paint. If you hit another player with paint enough, then they sort of like die and respawn. And then when you cover an area with your color paint, you can dive into that paint and travel much faster and you can recharge your paint gun.
Yeah.
But then when you are in someone else's paint, you go really, really slowly. So it's kind of like it behooves you to lay a path forward. It's kind of like, it's literally kind of like putting the tracks in front of the train a lot of the time, of going like, I want to get over there. The fastest way to get there is spray, dive, and go up. And then you're covering as much of the map as possible in your color.
Splatoon 3 is going to have "it behooves you" on the
I was certainly proud of wriggling that one in there.
Well, and a big part of the main Turf War game, which they sort of started in one as the main way to play the game was that it wasn't pushing people to be overly competitive or aggressive. It was like there are different ways to play this.
Yeah, but that strategy and whether or not you focus on trying to cover new areas or go over the areas that the other team
or stay
covered.
Back at your home base and ink up all of that because no one else is doing that. So a big part of the appeal with the original Splatoon is that it didn't have to be you were awesome at, you know, out shooting or out gunning or out inking other players. You could just stay back and work on that, because at the end of the Turf War maps, doesn't matter how many kills each side's got.
Yeah.
There is a meter that studies the map and says this team got the most ink on it, this team wins.
Yeah, it's very clever because it's giving particularly younger players the opportunity to play a shooter type game that has nothing to do with guns or like shooting
or focusing on
shooting other people. It's really
quite I will
clever.
Say that worked in Splatoon 1 because it was such a new concept and people were all a bit shit at it, so everyone was sort of like, what are we doing?
Yeah.
Since now being the third game, you can come up against people who are just amazingly good. They are using the elite sniping weapon from the back of the map. And
right,
you,
yeah, okay.
You do run into some teams occasionally that you're like, this stops feeling fun, and you are just... There's something as well about, like, not just losing a match because you had less kills than the other team, but they shat all over your side of the map. They came over and they're like, we were here. We didn't let you get off
the
spawn.
We inked everywhere.
We inked everything. And you're like, oh my God. So yeah, that's the core game, which is unchanged here. If anything, as I said, they just have built on it with other modes that the value add there is that you get tired of one mode and there's another mode that is different enough that it's fun to move across to. And the last one I'll mention here is this little extra mini game they've bolted on, which is a card game. It's hard to find, actually. It's just a little card game.
Is it in the town hub thing?
You got to go down a little back alley and find a tape where they're playing it. You're dealt these cards, which you play one at a time against each other, and you're trying to kind of like Minesweeper. You're trying to close off those orange blocks or your special blocks to get more points, but you can't obviously... you can only attach the colored squares to more colored squares. So there's sort of, it's basically turf war. You're trying to ink as much of the board at the same time as the other person. There's some nuance to it in terms of power levels and that kind of stuff. It's not overly complex, but it's fun. Mm-hmm. It's so far only against AI. So I wonder if they're looking at implementing that against other players.
It also feels like something they absolutely should spin off for mobile.
On mobile. Yeah. Yeah. I'd love this on mobile. It's a nice little completely different looking and feeling vibe game within the mix. So yeah, again, my sort of final point on it is just I've really enjoyed, yes, it is remains largely unchanged, but what is there is really good in all three or four modes, that the second you're tired of single player, there's co-op. The second you're tired of co-op, you go and play some PvP. The second you're tired of that, you play this little mini game against the computer, then you're back to single player, and the whole loop starts again. It's very easy to not put down shit phrasing, Gus, but it's a very fun game to just find a different way to play consistently. And in that sense, yeah, I think they've done a really, really good job. There's heaps of little like tweaks to weapons and power-ups and the stuff that I haven't really noticed, not being a hardcore Splatoon fan, but I think that's there for
and
some.
And so what's the player base like now if you want to jump online and play competitively with other people?
It's been a mixed bag, I think. I've been dying to jump on with some Pocketeers and play.
Do you mean
like,
in terms of talent or just skill? Availability again?
Oh, sorry, I meant availability, yeah.
It's consistent. Yeah, it is always there. The only thing I'll say is Australians have been struggling a little bit with internet connectivity. I mean, I'm using the Switch OG, and that thing sucks just in general. It's next to my router, and occasionally just can't connect to the internet. So depending on what version of a Switch you're on, I'm sure that differs. But yeah, that's the only issue, being I don't play Nintendo Switch games online predominantly because... yeah, that sucks. But I've had dropouts. We saw one earlier on. They seem to be getting better. I don't know if that's just me or the servers or whatever's happening. But yeah, there's always a game to play. And I think that's been consistent with the previous two Splatoons.
Yeah.
So.
I'm very excited to check. I only played a little bit, but I'm so keen to check it out. And particularly, I forgot about the card thing, which is cool. But the Salmon Run was so good and it sucked. The time zone stuck. The timed stuff sucked. Yeah. So yeah, totally.
Yeah. No, it's heaps of fun. So yeah, Splatoon. And just quickly, the other thing I'll touch on is last week I mentioned that I jumped back into Middle-Earth Shadow of War to play some of the DLC because watching Rings of Power has me
Galadriel
just like...
something?
That was Blade of Galadriel, which was part one of the two-part DLC that they released years ago. I was just, I had the urge to carve up some orcs and I jumped into that. That was a very extension of what the original Shadow of War was. It was just new character, a bit more Mordor... go out there, hunt down some orc captains, have some fun, do all of that. I'm now playing The Desolation of Mordor, and holy shit.
That's a different map.
This is a different map. I'll try and just condense this quickly. This is another self-contained area. You are no longer in Mordor. You're
That's
out.
So different.
You're out in the east. You are playing
of America.
Well, there's the Easterlings, which are the sort of mercenaries and that kind of thing. You're in an eastern area of Middle Earth. You play a Gondorian guard. You are out there to recruit mercenaries to help fight your war. There are orc fortresses.
Like Metal Gear Solid 5?
Sorry?
Like Metal Gear Solid 5?
I mean, a little bit.
Are you vaulting right people back to your base?
Kind of. Yes. You are taking over outposts.
Yes.
And then you are hiring or paying for mercenaries, and you're putting them in charge of those outposts.
Yes.
Where they have to consistently fight and keep it defended.
That's Metal Gear Solid 5, but with a coherent story.
It is. and with some fucking tremendous voice acting in the story elements that are here. There are single. There's story missions to take part in, but there's also just head out there and take over outposts and take down the hierarchy of the orcs. And the way you do, and the voice acting's great. The character is mortal, so it's a roguelite. So if you die, all the orc captains reset.
Oh, I hate that.
No, it's done very well because the story progression remains, your currency and powers and everything remain. I know it doesn't.
But all the dudes you killed, Gus.
Well, that's kind of that's the thing that you want to keep coming back to. Like once you finish the story, you want to jump back in and just have a constant burn.
Do they remember you?
I think some of them do. I get confused. But maybe that when they reset, maybe they do. Yeah, I'm not too sure.
This was 2014 as well. This is like roguelite wave mode before it
That's
became
what
the
I mean.
Thing that
the
is in everything
The roguelite elements
now.
Of it are awesome. Because you're immortal, you don't have all the Celebrimbor powers. You have all these gadgets like a grapple and a parachute and all this
Say
other
it.
Stuff.
Celebrimbor.
Loves it. And you can hire mercenaries that you can call in to help you mid-battle.
Mm-hmm.
The outpost takeovers, if you skip just a little further forward, is everything I fucking wanted from this right now. It was just hardcore, just Middle Earth, orc slashing. A little further forward, get into the action. Once it starts,
hey.
It is just this all-out brawl with some of the most fun combat that I forgot is just fantastic. The moves, the camera angles, the power-ups, everything.
There's little slowdowns as you do the little flips over
the
top and
counters,
stuff.
All that. There's like little dune sandworms that you can set off, that little patch of sand. You can hit with a little bow and arrow and suddenly a sandworm comes up. There's your guys running around. It's just chaotic and it is so much fun.
Cool.
It's exactly what I felt like, again, after watching the latest episode. I'm just like, I want to get into Middle-earth. I just want to hack and slash. I did not expect it to be this complex in terms of there's these systems going on which are like you are upgrading your gear, you are moving through a narrative story, but the world resets and your mercenaries all can get defeated. They can get killed on the battlefield. You lose money and then you have to invest it into other...
And there was a bit of like... There was quite large from memory from the main game, and I'm not sure if it's like this in the DLC, but like you would come across a building where there was some strategy into how you would take it down and stuff, where you would have to be like, okay, I need to hit those two B things and then I need to go in this way and then I need to try and...
This one is a lot more about heading in there. You have to literally this circle, you have to fight your way into that circle and claim it. So it is less tactical in that sense. There's definitely, you can stealth your way through it, or you can drop Caragor, meat for the Caragors and set them all off and all that kind of...
Oh, Caragor!
You can ride them.
There's all that.
That's an ability that you learn to ride the Caragor.
That's all still here, but it does feel like the emphasis in this is full-fledged, like, war. Like, you are going in and your troops take on their troops, and you just get caught in these amazing battles. And again, if you do die, you reset back to the area you were in. The narrative still continues the way it was, but... all the orc captains reset. And again, I think that's so the game can be played continually from there. So how different this is to Blade of Galadriel, how different this is from just regular Shadows of Mordor, it's just so much fun and feels
what
like a
happening?
Completely different game.
And this is another
like
paid DLC.
So here's something I messed up. It's actually right now, I think it's still on sale. It's $8 for the season pass, which gets you Blade of Galadriel and this, and it's on Game Pass for free. So if you went right now and got Shadows of War, it's on Game Pass, and then you pay $8, you get this and last week's one, instead of $20 and $25 if you bought them separately. I don't know if that sale's still happening. It looked like it was kind of persistently on sale if you have Game Pass, I guess. But yeah, it wasn't $8 each. It's $8 for both. And this is fantastic. If you were just like me and you've watched a bit of the show or you've just rewatched the movies and you're like, I just want to play, this combat is still just as fun as it was back then.
Yeah.
And oh, the orcs from last week, they just got better. They got better. There's like a comedy duo called Boom and Gloom and they're like, they're doing a little song and dance while they've got these angry voices.
And from memory, there was like, again, I don't know if this is part of the DLC, but like there was like, you could get intel that would give you information about the orcs and then you could learn their weaknesses and stuff like that.
Scared of Caragors, doesn't like, you know, bees or all that kind of stuff. Loves bees is arrow-proof.
Loves bees.
Loves bees is arrow-proof.
The writing and...
Unstoppable.
Yeah. The writing and the capture performances from all of it is just fantastic. And it doesn't feel like 2014.
The bees make him stronger.
Seriously, they get enraged. If there's one that likes bees and you hit bees, he goes... Someone mentioned it just looks like fun, Aussie Manny. This is just so much fun. I can't suggest it enough if again, you're feeling that itch for carving through some orcs. It is great.
Yeah, awesome.
Yeah, so I'm done with my... I think this is... I'll just keep playing this after I watch episodes of it. Because
whatever sales spike is seen
by Warner Brothers right
for this DLC is 100% because of you.
Yeah.
Peter.
You don't get it.
Sure.
What have you been playing this week?
Well, Steph and I have both been playing Wayward Strand, which is by a little Aussie studio. What's the name of the dev team? Sorry to throw you on the bus.
No. I just looked it up because I'd forgotten as well.
Yeah. Ghost Pattern.
Ghost Pattern.
Ghost Pattern. And it is a narrative kind of like really chill kind of game. It's definitely like a... It's definitely a storybook style game about interacting with characters. There's not a lot of gameplay outside of you find yourself in the scenario as this like young teen and kind of talk to everyone and kind of unfurl the story that is not like a mystery or anything. It's kind of just about character interaction and dialogue. Do you want to...
Where are you up? Where are you up to?
I finished like the first chapter.
Sure. Okay, cool. Because, I feel like there's a little bit of mystery to it.
There's a little bit of mystery to it, but it seems very...
It's not like a murder mystery type, like whodunit type thing. But it's a visual novel. The setup is that, you're a teenager. You've gone to work with your mum, who is a nurse in a sort of an elderly, I want to say facility, but it's an airship.
What a twist.
Yeah. So it's an airship that has been converted into a nursing home.
Wow. Yeah.
On the ground or in the air?
It's in the air.
Okay.
The art is delightful.
Yeah.
The dialogue is really sweet and the voice, it's got a great voice cast, all Australian. Great voice cast. Michael Caton from like The Castle and Pack to the Rafters and stuff. Madge
from Neighbours.
Madge from Neighbours. Recognised her voice instantly.
Very smoky. I remember even back in the day.
Gives you a good feeling just hearing both of their voices in it because it feels like it's wonderful to play a game like this and hear so many Australian voices and then have those kinds of voices in there that take you back are really awesome. I just really, really love the art. I think the game is beautiful to look at. There's so much detail in each of the rooms, particularly since you're meeting a lot of different characters that, you know, you're trying to, as a child, understand about who they were when they were younger based on this sort of very small picture you have of them in their little rooms. And the little items that they have that are kind of speaking to their past and stuff like that. There's a lot of love and detail that has gone into all the design of those little things.
Yeah.
And are you always staying in conversation mode with these people or are you going and like living their life?
It's kind of like you are the child.
Yep.
And it's kind of like the layout is this like side scroll, kind of bisection
diorama
of the airship. And you only can move left and right. And then interact with the people, and there's three floors.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you kind of move up and down the floors, and you might get a piece of information from someone about someone else. So then you take that piece of information to the other person to try and kind of like develop the character interaction that way.
Yeah, you're definitely rewarded for trying to get as much information out of people, but it's also one of those kinds of conversations where you can say the wrong thing and upset someone a little bit and maybe not go down the conversation path that gives you the answers that you need. So you kind of have to be tactful and be listening to what other people say about other people so that when you go back to them, you're like, oh, I know that this will be a touchy subject for them.
So I'll avoid it.
Yeah.
And the writing is good?
Yeah. It's sweet. Mm-hmm. Like it's not like profound, but it's lovely.
Yeah, all the characters are, I would say, written quite distinctly and definitely performed distinctly.
Yeah.
I find them all really like, the way that the game is broken up is into, and kind of the driving part of the narrative is that your mum's brought you here, you're on school holidays, and mum's like, you need to hang out with all the oldies because we're busy. Because in 3 days, there's basically an inspection, a government inspection on why is this a freaking airship and why have you got old people in here? Is this like, can we keep this thing running?
Yeah.
And so you're just this sweet little, like, you're effectively this naive thing that's just arrived in this space that's like a pre-existing scenario, and you're kind of piecing together all the things that the adults have been up to. And
there's mystery around the ship and why it exists and what it was before.
Yeah, okay. So they're not just ignoring that as a fanciful setting where they're like, it'll be fun to put it here. It's like, it's part of the narrative.
That's going to be part of it for sure.
Okay.
I think, it's beautiful. Yeah, it's really, really lovely. It definitely is setting you into a particular pace. It doesn't let you kind of skip through dialogue. It doesn't you like skip through to the end of the line or whatever. It's like you are very passively like you choose dialogue options and you just have to wait for them to play out and you hear all the voice.
But it is
stuff.
Fully voice acted with all those actors, right? Like everything is
But you can't skip through anything.
Yeah.
Which is fine, and as a choice, I totally understand, because I think particularly in being that it's sort of set in a nursing home, it wants you to experience things at a certain pace.
It also wants you to listen to these characters, I'm sure, where a big part of it is like, come on, Grant, man, like, let's speed it up a little.
Just every now and again, I'm like, oh, this is a big, I could just skip to the end of that because I don't need to listen to it. I can just, I can read it and...
Totally. Yeah. It's almost one of those things where I'm like, I kind of wish I could turn off speech bubbles in, obviously they need to be there for... a variety of reasons, but in that, because I'm like, I don't want to jump ahead and then get impatient. Like, I don't feel like that when I'm watching a TV show of like, just get to the end of your sentence. So, cool. Yeah, I'm really keen to check this one out. I've got it as well. We also have some codes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
They gave us some we've got 3 codes to give away.
Oh, lovely.
So we should just do some Nightbot rolls. Do we want to do it now? Do we want to do it?
Let's do it now.
Let's do it now. Can we pick 3 at once? I think we can do 3 at once, right?
I reckon.
Yeah, cool. Yeah. Do you know what platform they are?
Steam.
Steam? Beautiful. Steam codes. We've got 3 Steam codes to give away. If someone could help us with that. Ben, the codes are sitting in the Back Pocket Game Slack channel, so you can just grab them from there. What do you want the code word to be?
Should it be...
Madge.
Madge is good.
That's tricky to spell.
Madge.
People might write Minge.
It should be Minge then, shouldn't it?
Should be.
For the people who are going to spell it. Not for this lovely game.
No? Beautiful game. It's Madge. It's Madge.
Madge.
M-A-D-G-E.
M-A-D-G-E.
Madge.
Airship?
No, Madge.
Airship?
Madge for a code. I was getting not the same vibes, but I talked about Spiritfarer a while back.
Oh, yeah.
Same vibes, but it was like, it was a platformer where you moved around a ship and you had these fanciful creatures that represented, I think, similar
people
kind of personalities.
In the later stages of life.
That kind of stuff. So lovely to,
There's totally a similarity there, I think. And even in the color palette, I think, that they've chosen. That it's really nice. It gives you a good feeling. It was hard. It was hard to stop playing.
Is it even running yet?
No. Sorry, guys.
the mods are setting up because this came in hot. Added this right at the end. So, apologies, mods.
Sorry, mods. I was playing it before we came into the city, and it was hard to stop because I was kind of invested in what was happening. So it was really nice.
Yeah, cool. And Will, Josh worked on this, right?
He did. I saw brief glimpses of menus and...
Oh, yeah.
Numbers.
The heady world of game development.
Menus and numbers.
The way of the coder.
Back pocket, ready. All right, we'll turn on emote only and exclamation mark.
Oh, no, it's
just
gone.
Just Madge.
Yep. Yeah, Madge.
I just get paranoid that if anyone's going to ever misspell, if a word is not a super obvious word to spell.
That's what makes it a game of skill.
Yeah.
I see it typing out Madge correctly.
Yeah. Will, do you recognize any of Josh's handiwork in the game where you're like, the way that, that cup gets picked up?
Totally.
That's very Josh.
Just the way text appears. It's very soft and
disappears.
Yeah, and disappears. Yep. That took a little while. So, appreciate the fact that you don't have to always see things.
Beautiful.
Nice.
And Cut it. If you misspelled Madge, well, it's your own fault. Someone did write Mind.
Bear Skinner, first time in chat, entering with Madge. Welcome.
There you go. Nice. Fantastic. And we're going to get the winners. And the first winner is...
Cut a lot.
Yeah.
Cut a lot
is getting the code. The second winner is...
Can we run it like that?
Yeah.
Do it.
Do it.
Do it.
Crazy.
Do it. Super Studios.
Oh, Super Studios. I feel like Super Studios has won before.
We've definitely said Super Studios' name in
we've said this
Super Studios kind of context.
Coastal, yeah,
yeah. We've said that name before.
Don't know if we've ever said that name before, but Coastal.
The
well done.
Coastal.
Yay.
Oh, this is a chat. Cute. Welcome, Coastal. And enjoy that copy again.
How exciting.
Thank
how
you
lovely.
Very much to the Wayward Strand devs for that as well. Yeah, it is. I've seen some talk about this on like bigger sites and stuff as well, so hopefully this does get the sort of like broader international look. That
it's been. It's been... in kind of the sphere of like conversation in podcasts and stuff like that for a couple of years now,
because
it's been worked on for quite some time, and I know that it got like a bit of traction 2 years ago, and because I was looking at trailers from it today.
Imagine it probably demoed somewhere and caught someone's eye.
Yeah.
Sorry, I heard Madge was probably demoing it.
Madge's demoing.
I was like, Madge was out there just working on
That's what I would do. I'd get Madge to shop it around as much as possible.
Madge was
willing.
A booth babe. Tied to a switch showing this game.
And Harold's walking around going, you should play it.
But it's come obviously a long way in the last couple of years, and particularly in the design of the ship and stuff, it's like, it's really like a beautiful space to walk through.
It makes you feel good to play it, but and it's I love any story that has that prompts you to kind of be investigative in finding out things about people. You know what I mean? Not just a bit like, oh, I've got to figure out what happened, or I want to, you know, I've got to explore the space. It's like I need to find out
where does this lever go.
I need to find out what is the story with each of these different people. Totally. And why is it And each of them is relevant and has a storied past in their own ways. That's nice.
Yeah. Cool. Beautiful.
Yeah.
Pete, what else? Cool.
Little Orpheus.
I am.
Little Orpheus came out like last night or something. Wasn't on our game plan.
Yeah.
Came out of nowhere.
Yeah.
It's by the Chinese Room, the Dear Esther devs. Amnesia.
Really?
Yeah. And it's really freaking cool. It is a like side scrolling platform adventure, and you play as this Russian scientist who was placed inside a drill to drill to the center of the Earth.
Incredible! What a way to get there.
The drill collapses.
Was the scientist? Hopefully, there was the scientist spinning around in the drill. Is all I'm asking.
I think he was in a stable part of the.
You think when the drill got to the bottom and ink got stuck, he started spinning.
He starts spinning.
Holy shit! Look at this thing.
Yeah,
it's stunning.
It's beautiful.
Has he gone back in time or into like a?
No. Well, so it's basically like Journey to the Center of the Earth, right? He's cracked through the crust.
I was just about to say this character looks small for the environment that they're in.
Yeah, so they're in like he's in like the prehistoric undercrust. Yeah.
Got it.
That we all know is down there.
Oh, no.
It's broken into episodes. The scenario is that this person has escaped the center of the Earth, and they are now being interrogated by the Russian military who sent them down there in the first place, because the nuke that got sent down inside the drill is lost.
The
drill that he went down in,
okay.
It was carrying a nuke, it crashed, he fell out, bits and pieces fell out, and it's like... He gets back somehow, but we don't know, back in time. He's telling the story, so the entire time there's this dialogue,
amazing.
And not the entire time, but a lot of it there's this dialogue between this character and the Russian military dude who's like, you're full of shit. It's all very playful and quite cutely written. There's an amazing score. And Will, if you go back to the start of this where you saw that kind of animation and...
Is it just platforming?
Just platforming.
Like,
pump the music a little bit.
Oh, yes.
Oh, wow. Catch Me If You Can.
And it's a James Bond title. It is Catch Me If You Can. Mm.
And this is the title sequence that plays at the top of every level.
Fuck yeah, they knew it was too good to just use money.
Yeah.
And Will, you can bring the music down, and then we'll go to the end of a level. We'll go to the end of the first level. So it should be like the last couple of minutes of the clip. So most of the game is you're moving through these just stunning environments.
So gorgeous.
And platforming around. Little puzzles, quite basic, but it's not really about...
It was
the gameplay as much as it is like
look at you.
The conversation.
Need
yeah.
to get to the end of the
it's totally
level.
Just about like the conversation that are happening, which the dialogue is happening constantly. The music is beautiful. It's
and
really
the conversations
just,
are always with the.
Do tell me, what was this brilliant
idea, General? I ran like hell, General.
Just the narrative.
I am
it's so
such a sucker cartoon. For when music and dialogue is coordinated and synced with your gameplay, where it's like it's narrating what you're doing
it,
in
it feels like you're as much on a journey
that
or
is
you're
so
on a
cool.
ride, you know, as you are sort of controlling the character.
I'm so into this shit. Should I buy it right now? Lee, is it worth me getting?
Yeah, it's less than $20.
Yeah, it's $16.
It's like, it's I think 10 episodes. I'll get to the end of the episode in just a sec and we can just let this play out and I'll explain a bit more about the game. It's not... Yes, for $16, absolutely. Everyone should play it.
Yeah, that's all 10
It's not perfect.
Not episodic.
Yeah, no, sorry, it's, okay. That's all the episodes. It's not perfect. It feels clunky in some areas and the animation isn't that good in some areas, but the package of it is brilliant. Like...
Survive the jaws of the
all this kind of like
nice. Episode like
miles underground as an aperitif for a ravenous raptor. What aperitif. Dark secrets could be buried in the lost city of Agartha?
Find
Will
out
the general
next week?
Ever discover the location of his lost bomb? All of these questions and more will be answered in the next exciting episode of Little Orpheus.
Credits roll.
Yes.
At the end of every level,
yes.
The credits roll.
Yes.
That's
oh,
so
and they're
funny.
Genuine
that's
game developers.
That's the actual credits. Yeah.
Yeah.
And then you just go play next episode.
Most games should do that because most games people never finish. So it should
yeah,
be like
yeah.
you just every Ubisoft game after you get off the first
you
island,
the
it should be the title card.
And
it, should
it should
be the credits.
Credits.
Yeah. But you should put different people at the top of the credits each time so that we
yeah,
get
yeah,
through.
Yeah. Good.
You go through.
Yeah.
Everyone.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome.
And. Yeah, the presentation of it is amazing. The each level looks like it's really distinct. So I'm keen as
Terraformer says Apple Arcade exclusive. Oh,
okay,
oh
that's
my
where
God.
It's come from.
I was just about to say this looks like it would be great on a phone.
And it totally that explains kind of the game feel of it feeling like
a little
yeah.
bit
less
on
than
here,
less
yeah.
than like less than a Limbo in terms of how like. Nice it feels to play
yeah.
a platformer.
Yeah.
And that's also probably why it's not on the game plan is all the re-release
yeah.
stuff we tend that's, to just ditch because
yeah.
it's
yeah.
like,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
oh, sick. I've got it already because I have Apple Arcade. Awesome.
There you go.
Yep.
So still on Apple Arcade.
Yeah.
Yeah, just yeah, not exclusive.
It's just come to other stuff now, yeah.
There you go.
Yeah, so yeah, and again, as soon as I saw it and I was like, that looks pretty cool, and then I saw the Chinese room and I was like, holy shit.
Yeah, totally.
I had no idea they'd
work. I think Apple Arcade really invested in a lot of like developers to just make stuff because they wanted to like really boost the platform.
Yeah.
So there were a lot of, I think, developers who would just like, we were offered by Apple Arcade to kind of make a game and this is what we pitched and this was the idea. So it was kind of a cool way to support new ideas.
Totally.
Yeah.
Also, did I talk about Apple Arcade last week?
No.
I don't think so. I will just say, and again, sorry, another kid story, but Banjo is ripening at the age where he's getting into iPad games and there is so much fucking trash out there that is just, it is so predatory to like with ads and it's just appalling. And
is it also, sorry to interrupt, but is it the traditional predatory thing with this microtransaction, this ads? I imagine there's also just obnoxious attention keeping games
so,
that aren't actually just
so
doing anything.
It is a combination of both. It is a attention keeping game that is interrupted by an ad, a full screen video ad, where the X close button, tiniest fucking thing on the planet that a kid can't like get. I can't even get half the time. If you click anywhere else, it either pauses the ad and then you have to click again to unpause it, or it takes you to the app store to download that shitty app. And it's just ridiculous. But I did, and
it's an Apple Arcade curated.
So I was about to say, nearly did was just delete all the things. And then I remembered I have Apple Arcade and went through and I was like, oh my God, all these amazing games on there. Like he's playing Cut the Rope and like these fun, brilliant puzzle games. So yeah, if you have kids out there, Apple Arcade is actually really worth the investment for like knowing there's no microtransactions and no
totally.
Apps.
But
yeah.
it's interesting.
And they're high quality games as well. They've
totally.
Really curated anything that makes it onto Apple Arcade is like, it's got to be of a certain level.
Yeah. That's the second time that I've been Apple Arcaded not aware.
Because
South of the Circle.
Exactly.
Oh, yeah.
Which is also brilliant.
Yeah, right.
And
doesn't feel like a game great with a gamepad. Mm. I was like, this isn't that. This yep. doesn't have a good game feel, but it's yep. an amazing story.
Got arcaded.
Yeah, I got arcaded again.
Great. Beautiful. Love the look of this. That's so exciting. Oh, that's so good. Was that it for Little Orpheus?
That's it for Little Orpheus.
Will.
We'll find out next week.
Sorry. Roll the credits.
Stuff from Little Will, not Little Orpheus, is a game called You Suck at Parking, which came out this morning. I've been very excited for this. I joined a Discord for this. That's how, like,
oh my goodness. Really?
Yeah, yeah.
This game?
Yeah. I played the entire demo, and the demo was one of those demos where it kind of was the whole game. Like,
sure.
It
sure,
gave you a good amount of it, to the point where I was excited to know when I could play all of it.
You talked about this on the show, right? Or did I watch
it? I think
you play?
I did. Yeah, I think okay. I briefly, yeah, talked about it when the demo dropped. I think it was part of one of the Steam Fests.
Yeah.
But yeah, the full game's dropped. It is this. It is basically...
Amazing.
As simple as that. But basically, once you stop, you can't go again. So you have to time your break.
That's right. That's I played cool the demo and it's tons of fun.
It's
yeah.
so
good.
Have you played it in multiplayer? I'm keen to check out. Like,
no, I haven't.
So it's up chaos. To eight. It's up to eight people online.
Amazing.
I'm super keen to put this in as just like one of my little party games with my mates to be like, between other rounds, we're going to try this stupid chaotic game, which
totally.
Actually
totally.
Fun.
I love that.
There's a level fairly near, like deeper into where I've been, where there's other cars, and even this is intense. So I imagine with friends will be proper chaos. It's great. It's very simple in premise. It does everything that like a puzzler does, where it's like firewalls that you can't hit and like ledges that are just tedious in like that are annoying, but it's packaged wonderfully. It's what I was hoping for from the demo, and
the kind of thing you need to sort of get into a rhythm of knowing the physics of it and the limits of what you can do. And
totally.
Is it a pass-fail state, or is there a grade/score that you're chasing?
There's a timer for every level, so once that's run out, you don't get another car to try, and it's like, get it done in this one or else. But because there's multiple parking spots throughout the level, if you've gotten one of them, that counts as a pass, but it's not the gold.
Cool. Yeah, all right.
It's kind of like island based as well, so it's like get enough gold to open the next set of.
And so
tracks.
Is it just like level based? Like you have to just restart the level, or?
Yeah, like that's kind of the answer. You've completed it, and
Did we do this as a very good gameplay for the demo?
No.
Okay, I played it then. This could be a fun, good gameplay, very good gameplay, maybe next
multiplayer.
Week. Yeah, I was thinking about it for this week, but we knew
it's,
we were doing things.
It looks like a perfect Game Pass game too. It's that totally. Thing of just like, as an investment in your time and how wacky, but as you said, we're like, get there.
Brilliant.
Been to that your gameplay, Will?
Yes, it
Hero.
Is. Been to that Coles car park?
The best bit about this level as well is, I don't know which one it is, but I think it was earlier, my car blew up. I landed up the top. It was one of the other bomb levels. And I was like, oh God, I'm never going to get this. But the husk of the car, the shell, continued rolling and it hit. And then I got a trophy and I was like, what the hell's going on? And the trophy was like, you got to park with a dead car. I'm like, amazing. So there's a bit of strategy in that. It's like you could just throw a car at a spot.
Yeah. And I can't remember, does the parking spot, for lack of a better word, suck you in? Like,
not particularly.
Is it like a golf game where, like, you know, an arcadey golf game where, like, if you get there, you can't overshoot it. Once you are touching it, you're in.
No, it is definitely very finicky. Like even a single tire, like this kind of thing where it's like, and you get that.
Yeah,
that didn't count.
Yeah,
because you went past and your bumper wasn't on and off. And
that's great. How much of your car needs to be in the parking spot? The whole thing.
Yeah, basically, at least a whole tire intentionally, not just you've overshot it.
And, so you can a quarter of your car can be in the space.
Yeah.
Would you be comfortable explaining this park to a police officer?
Officer, you'll see my husk is parked.
Somebody told me once that when there's like a no stopping sign or whatever, and you can park on the other side of it, that more than 50% of your vehicle has to be over it, and that counts. And I've been living by that rule forever. And then I remember I was parking with Peter once, and I was like, more than half my car has passed the sign. And Peter's like, that's not a thing. And I was
that's
like,
something people tell themselves that they are fine.
Why the sign's there. That's what the sign's for.
When you come back in half,
there's an arrow on the sign. Saying this way.
I've heard that same thing too. So yeah, it is something.
It's like when you go to a bank, you can remove half the total money from the bank as long as there's still some money in there.
Do you suck at parking in real life, Will?
No, I'm pretty good. I'm pretty good. I'm, and this isn't to big head of myself. Like, I do the parks where someone in the car goes, oh, okay, you're going.
Oh,
I've done them too.
Which always feels really nice. I'm not perfect at them, but it's a nice thing of like, oh, you find that impressive. That's
Let's put that on your Tinder.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Ken decent park. Parking.
Apparently,
let's get control of your Tinder.
Apparently, yeah, okay. A lot of people like this one. Like,
new segment.
An attractive aspect. Tinder.
Oh, yeah, fuck, Will, please.
Is doing that, the reverse round?
Yeah.
For some people,
Because you put the arm there?
I don't even think it's the arm. It's just the, like...
I think it is. I think it's because you get real close. I think it's because you...
Well, I'm erect.
You put the arm there, and then you're putting your face closer to the person.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And 100%. They can smell your musk.
100%. It's the parking musk.
You do have a musk.
Yeah, 50%
of your musk. But you have mentioned to me, and I only feel comfortable saying this now because
you said that. Am I going
to
feel comfortable?
No. Just in terms of... You have said to me before, and I can't remember the full context, so what I'll do is just... I will just make up what I wished the story would have been. And you were like, you know the way to turn a woman on. No, but you were basically saying that there's something about how you not holding the steering wheel and doing the palm like your driving power move. So it's basically like leaning back a bit, getting relaxed and kind of like doing that.
That means the fingers are still free.
I knew he'd take it there.
Peter Burns.
No, what I'm saying, and it's not like just the turn. It's
logistically, your fingers are free, but they're still on the wheel. What's happening?
Get on, baby. You hop up. Let's get that Russian starfish going.
You hop up.
Let's take it back to what I was actually getting at, which is you turn with one hand.
Well,
it's the release and the slide of the. Oh, he's gone.
It's the release and the slide of the what? No.
It's the. It's the release and the slide of the wheel back around, the like as you do the turn, and
like
then you let go and let it go and let it grab it back.
Yeah,
none of this 10 and 2 stuff that you learn when you're doing this one.
I do a weird thing sometimes that I picked up from the person that taught me to drive, and I remember them being like, don't do this because this is a bad thing to do. And I was like, I'm so going to do that. And it's like when I'm turning, I turn my hand.
Oh, that's bad.
And I go like inside like this.
Yeah.
Because if you need to recorrect, I think your hands.
Yeah.
Try the one-hander and then and Peter will just be.
I feel like I've always surprised. I'm a terrible driver, but pretty good at parking.
Get on, Pete.
Pretty good at parking. But I think the cameras have like fucked me up a bit.
Oh, 100%.
Yeah. You know what I mean? Because then
now
that I'm looking at those, I'm like, I should have just, when I was instinct alone, I was a better reverse parker.
Also, I've got the new car with all the beeps and I haven't had beeps for years. And if I have to park in a really tight parking spot, I'm feeling really good about the fact that I parallel parked into something with like barely any room on either side. So I should be in a calm zen state if I fucking nailed that. I've got the reverse beeps and the front beeps going beep, 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 beep. I'm like, I know.
I know, God, baby, I know. I'm so sorry, all the beeping.
Can we do a little cutter here? Will, you laughed when he said it, and it means it needs to be in the intro next week. Mm-hmm. He said,
I haven't had the beeps in years.
Yeah, I've got all the beeps, and I haven't had the beeps in years.
Yeah.
And if you actually beep the times he says the word beep, that'll be a really good unnecessary.
Yeah, good.
There you go.
That'll be good.
The beeps in years.
That.
Will, before we move on to your next game, I just want to quickly say, remember that movie, The Counselor, where Cameron Diaz fucked a car?
I was just about to bring that up.
Yeah.
Saw that.
Yeah.
I did not like that film at all.
It was a weird movie, but that was a memorable scene.
And I think Cameron Diaz, I think, I'm pretty sure she kind of like...
Hasn't
worked since.
She did bad.
She doesn't have to.
No, that was before.
No, but I think also that was like a weird choice, and I think she potentially regretted it and it followed her forever.
I would certainly be unhappy if she was not happy with it, but and removing the fact that when The Mask came out, I had the biggest teenage crush on Cameron Diaz possible. I don't remember shit all about that movie, but I remember that
scene.
And I will remember that for the rest of my life. Yeah. And I genuinely think that all art should strive to have something that just like embeds in your memory in the same way. Like, so bravo, counseling. Cameron Diaz, I'm on your side.
Wasn't it like a well-received book?
Maybe.
So I think
that scene would have lost a lot.
Well, I think the idea was that scene was in the book and everyone's like, that scene's amazing to read, but it couldn't be done on film, and then they did it.
It's the unfilmable book just because of that scene.
Were her legs like that in the book?
I didn't read it.
All right. Let's find out in the post show.
There we go. Will.
Yes.
Seamless. What else?
Absolutely. Not much to say on this one, but I jumped into the original Dead Island off the back of the sequel still existing.
Yep.
By request of the guy that I don't live with anymore. And it's...
Are you allowed to say his name?
No. It's only ever made or, you know, occupation. But,
yeah, okay.
This is good fun. It's also, it's kind of the thing we're talking about with Saints Row, in the old game jank that is just janky enough that it's fun. This is an actual old game, but there's because it's a very strange game to play. I've never played it. Like I never played the original or when it came out.
Yeah.
And like at least the 3 hours that we played, it was talking to one guy who said, "Go talk to everyone else. Do what they do." We did that, and then he came back.
And was he Aussie? But he was like a.
It was every accent.
Yeah,
okay.
It was like it was a mix of a lot of
the Australian
things.
It was like
Pacific Islander with a New Zealand Australian.
Totally.
Yeah.
So it was a very mission like jank of just like a terrible way to structure a game, but. There was fun to that because all the missions were just like go grab that thing, then, and all the characters are so tropey and silly that you create these fictions for each of them. So even though the mission is just go find a juice box for that person, there's fun in that. And yeah, no, it was cool to go back to an old game like this.
It's a lot of fun co-op.
So we
played a lot of this back in the good game days. This level of jank and
so good,
but it was fresh, and it was like the idea that you had this stamina that you really had to manage, your weapon degradation, these wonky fights.
The vehicles were very funny.
It just meant that but the co-op is so fun because you could look over and see someone
in the back of a cutscene.
Someone flailing going, "Huh," and getting overwhelmed. It was hilarious.
And you were just talking like quite seriously with someone.
Yeah.
It's genuinely like hard. Like I was surprised by like how ruthless.
I remember that too. Like, being really difficult. Yeah. You had to be very strategic. Like, anytime you left your base, you were kind of like, "Okay, we need to actually gear up for a run," because
it's kind of necessary in a zombie survival game. You need to see two people coming at you slowly and going, "Fuck, am I going to survive this?" Versus how many bullets
while you're carrying the petrol can.
Exactly. Like, quick, put it down.
The petrol and the cars and all of that kind of stuff is a lot to manage as well.
So are you keen for the sequel?
I am now. I hadn't had any consideration. I'm keen to keep going through this as well. Like I want to see. I've been like a lot of people in chat were saying, this is the pure jank. I was like, can I stand on this car? Will it be okay with this?
And it doesn't know. It's like maybe.
Yeah. I looked down at my
try and find out.
Not so much. I'm definitely keen for the sequel. The sequel looks a lot more like Deathloopy and stuff. It looks like it's embraced.
It definitely had that. The vibe of the trailer was a rinse, die, repeat sort of situation.
Get up every day in your LA apartment and going.
To me, it had like Dead Rising vibes. You know, the ones where it's just that dude killing zombies
In shopping malls.
Like it was promoting that kind of like ambivalence to the zombie threat.
Life goes on in a comical fashion, which is what the original trailer was.
The original trailer for this.
Well, that's what I mean. Totally. The original trailer for this is
the greatest trailers of anything ever.
Yeah.
But there's always like, it's a very different game when you've got something like this, which depending on what it is, I tend to prefer when there's kind of like scattered zombies and you can have moments where you get overwhelmed, but for the most part, you're kind of trying to be strategic, than the ones where you're just kind of constantly overwhelmed by massive hordes and you're just kind of like mowing them down en masse. I feel like, particularly for melee-based games, I guess, you kind of want something that's going
to
be
slower. I worry that the need to ramp up action and gameplay mechanics and movement with the sequel, coming off the back of your Dying Lights and all that kind of stuff, does it turn it into a, regardless, you are slightly OP and there's not that stress that you get from games like this, The Walking Dead, Saints and Sinners. It's like three zombies in a room. You're like, no, I might leave. It's a cool vibe for zombie games, which I feel like we've moved past because we have to keep the action ratcheting up, which is disappointing.
Yeah. And I'll tell you what else we've moved past all the talk about the fingers and the cars, which is a good thing because Grace just rated us.
Thank you so much, Grace.
Welcome everybody. It was watching Grace's stream. We hope you had a fun time playing video games.
Don't go back and look at what we talked about.
Don't go back.
You don't need to know.
Grace knows what she signed up for.
We're currently just talking about the games that we've been playing this week. Will's been going back and checking out Dead Island. The trailer for that for this one. I think about it all the time. I cannot imagine it being the developers and getting that trailer back from the marketing house that put it together.
Yeah.
I would just, if I was the lead creative on this game, I would walk up to the person who made it and I went,
you fucked us. Like, we cannot live up to this. Yeah. You have ruined this game.
But also, like, it was so fascinating how tonally different it was. Because there's no way that this dumb, fun, like, bashabout game wasn't well and truly into development 100%. When they went, all right, let's go and make the resort horror zombie trailer.
You could have just changed the character faces in the game and told me it was a Last of Us trailer, and I would have believed it more than
but
the trailer.
But that's it. Yeah, this game was never poking fun at itself. It's not tonally matching that trailer in a way that made anything sad, but it was trying and failing to be, like, serious, and every character was like, we want to survive. It just came off, when you put four people in it, running around.
I was gonna say, how do you not know that's gonna happen?
Exactly.
Yeah. Once you're in there and you're playtesting it, like, you're like, this is hilarious.
Which is why the trailer for the second one was the guy running along Venice Beach.
Yeah.
And it was like, we're going to have fun with this. And the trailer, again, now the re-release is like, we get it. It's silly. There's no
but
way.
Do you think it's going to be like Tommy Wiseau's like second effort in where he's like, oh no, it was meant to be a joke. And so I'm making like, it's meant to be funny. And then it's not going to be funny.
It could be. I have no idea what they're going to do with that second one. But again, go back and watch that first trailer for this.
We should watch the trailer in the post show.
We will.
Because I haven't seen it in ages, and it's and a beautiful piece of music as well. Yeah, so
I just have one little clip to show the jank that equals some fun, so I'll bring that up.
Are we going
to
hear the voice of He Who Shall Not Be Named?
Yeah, we shall. We shall. We might not see his face, though, ironically. But yeah, that's
take
all right.
Away.
Look at you hobble away with your juice!
Oh my god!
Oh my gosh! Hang on, I got a thing. Get a gun?
Oh no.
Anticlimactic.
That was great.
Hang on, I'll protect you.
Oh shit. There you go.
Oh, damn.
Beautiful. So, that's the fun of Dead Island. And I think tonight the sale ended, but it's like $3.87 on PlayStation, right?
Oh, wow.
So, if you want to get in with some friends, definitely.
I'm sure it's that sale is over and it is now back to $7.
Yeah.
I'm sure it's okay.
And rounding this out, I have not played too many games this week, actually, but I have watched something, and I can see up here in the top of the rundown where we list the games that we're talking about, I've written Cyberpunk Edgerunners, and someone, Angus, has screamed, "That's not a game, Nick!" exclamation mark. But it is an anime on Netflix that came out yesterday.
Fucking weeb.
I mean, we all could agree that anime sucks. It's very important to establish that first. And anyone who watches anime is a weirdo. Now, let me tell you about what could be my favorite TV show of the year if it wasn't Rings of Power. This thing is sick. This show is
awesome.
So sick. So it is the premise. It's set in the cyberpunk Night City world.
You are not anyone, you watch it.
No, yeah, I'm still thinking about videos. You are sitting on your couch and you open up Netflix.
Fascinating.
But the main character is a teenage kid,
David,
who comes from a poor background, but goes to school and manages to get his hands on a military grade cyber upgrade. And I've watched the first three episodes, I think, and basically it's like this kid, a thing happens in the first episode and his life becomes something a little bit different. He takes this military cyber upgrade and installs it, and then he starts meeting up with some other sort of vagabonds around Night City. I just love the visual ambition of this show. I think that it is so kinetic. It is so... The trailer is so intense. The show is much more slow-paced than that, but it is not a slow-paced show, but it's like, it does not assault you all the time. But it is constantly just taking an interesting angle on a shot, an interesting way of communicating visually, the feelings of the character. There is a... it does, like... Anime sucks, but the great anime... takes an idea and does something with it which you could never ever do with a camera, and that's like in real life, and that's what this does. I just think that it so much of this show is about communicating a mood and a feel and an environment of this horrible fucking city with so much originality and so much fun and so much like a combination of like violence and sex that is gratuitous, but I don't think
Gus, and you've watched a bit. I don't think it feels overly gratuitous in the way that maybe when you watch the trailer, which may have been a bit of your reaction, was just going like, oh my God.
Yeah, I found it super intense, the trailer.
It is,
like,
yeah,
I want to give it a go, but I find that a big barrier for me is just like, I'm not typically attracted to anime as an art style, which I feel like the color palette in this looks amazing. And I totally agree with you with the shots and stuff like that, but it's hard to get past that barrier.
Have you been enjoying it?
I've watched the first two episodes. I was not really engaged by the first episode. And I think that comes from a bit tonally whiplash about like the kind of anime I enjoy and how that's been evolving. And a big part of that I would say is the sort of East versus West version of animation when it comes to anime. And a big part of that, I think, touching on the fact that watching Arcane recently is watching an animation style that I find is just so pleasing and so modern and upgraded to a way that I'm like, this is how all animation should look and have this level of detail and care. And what this is by Trigger, who've done some more traditional anime. It is back to those more typical anime cells and angles and holds and reusing of certain plates and stuff like that, which there is an art to and is actually really lovely as well. And I loved watching, you know, Ghost in the Shell and Akira and all that kind of stuff. I mean, the two ones that every non-Asian person has watched that I know. Yeah. But I love them. And, you know, Aeon Flux and all that kind of stuff. But I've loved the Castlevania Netflix anime series, which is by a Western animation house. So with, I'm sure, a lot of influence. But what that has done has been a more traditional Western storytelling and a bit more pacey. And whereas this is back to the traditional sort of Eastern house of like, there's a lot of pausing and there's a lot of nothing and then there's suddenly a lot of action and there's like, and there's some weird stylistic choices to music. And I've turned on the Japanese voice and I'm doing that with the subtitles because I don't think the Western voice acting, English voice acting is good.
Mm-hmm.
It's not bad. It's just like,
I noticed that, but yeah.
I really, really found the characters grating and then I much preferred it in that state. And by the end of the second episode, I'm like, okay, I like this. The trajectory of the story felt less cliched. It felt like just angry, rebellious kid is going to fall in with the wrong crowd. But by the end of the second episode, I'm like, this is different. And it just took a little bit of rewiring to get back into enjoying a style like this. And I'm into it, bar the opening title song, which has no place being there. There is a Franz Ferdinand song that just sits in there almost like a kind of, well, this is different.
Ferdinand.
And it's like, this has nothing cyberpunky about it. And it has more of a Cowboy Bebop persona style, like, what a weird song to be listening to now. Mm. And it's like, okay, I don't like it. I will not. I love that song. I love the show. Mm-hmm. They do not belong together.
Full Metal Blitz said, apparently the subtitles are not accurate. So I've been watching in English, but I had the subtitles turned on because that's basically how I watch all TV now is with subtitles. And it's like, I feel like the subtitles are translation subtitles from Japanese. Like it's translating the Japanese dialogue into English. It is not transcribing the English lines. So it's often the same mood, but I'm watching something and I'm like, that's definitely not what that person's saying and reading something else.
Yeah,
But I'm so in on this. I really think Arcane is phenomenal. This is close to me in terms of, it is, you're right, there is the pausing and strange moments of pacing, but it is not
using some, like, coming back and then we see the same travel shot.
Yes, but it is not what you think of when you think of anime and how that stuff. No, it is not like the things where you go, they're over-explaining everything and everything is just like so like driven into the ground. It's like, it is constantly moving the story forward. I'm besotted with this. It's all the sort of like, it, you know, I mean, it's also just my vibe of like the gore, sex, like all that's just all the stuff that I kind of am really drawn
to. At the same time.
Exactly.
Kind of.
Watch the show. Yeah. And then the scene on there's a scene like on the moon, which was this beautiful for me, like this awesome, sick, like emo, cyberpunk version of a song. Like it's just, the whole thing was just like, Nick, enjoy this.
Yeah.
And I'm so, yeah. I'm so.
And is that why you're wearing that jacket tonight?
I need to be an edge runner.
Yeah. The thing I'll say about it as well that I think is a massive positive note on it is that the thing that was missing from Cyberpunk, the game of the 8 hours, 6 hours I put in, 4 hours I put into it, that I wanted to live in Night City. I wanted RPG elements. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And then I'm drawn into another story and the game just pulls you straight into that narrative. In fact, the game in the first hour gives you a big fuck you by saying here's a cutscene of you and Jackie living 2 years of what you should experience in this world.
That's the game
I wanted. That's the game I wanted to play. I was watching Jess streaming it, playing it for the first time. And again, every time I watch it, she's doing an escort mission for a crime boss. And I'm like, I want to see. I wanted that game to be more about living in my apartment, going through the humdrum, watching the fucking crazy teenage around me. Yeah, and this show is that. So I think that's a reason to enjoy it.
I will say I did ask Jess about it because I knew she was streaming Cyberpunk and I was like, are you going to watch this? And she watched one or two episodes or something. But she said that the city, it just feels like Night City.
It is so it.
And then also she got fight or flight response to the phone call thing that's in the show. And that's how you get missions of the game. And she's like, I just did not. Every time it came up, I was just like, ah. But so she's in cool that game right now. Totally. Yeah. But I'm just absolutely love it. And it's so worth just 20 minutes of your time to watch one episode.
I'll definitely try it. I mean, like, I don't play League of Legends and I don't watch animation. So the fact that I have seen Arcane all the way through three times now is
and watch the behind the scenes documentary.
And you said
The fifth episode goes into all of the foley and like the sound design for it and it is insane.
You doing premiere streams, getting into foley. Where was this when we worked at the ABC?
So good.
As you said it, Nick, 20 minutes as well of an episode, it's like, it's pretty inoffensive to say, like, I'm just going to watch one. And even if it wasn't my favorite, I'm like, that was, it's short. No, it's not 40-minute, 50-minute epic TV. So I think.
And you're not watching anything like it at the moment, I guarantee. So, like, it is, it's really.
How long is the season? How many episodes is the season?
10.
10 20-minute episodes.
Yeah. Cool. I think they're around 20 minutes. I said 20 minutes, but it didn't feel like a full half hour.
You skipped the Franz Ferdinand song.
Oh, yeah. It's like a 6-minute show.
Go listen to that song normally.
Which song is it?
Fire. This fire's out of control. Yeah. We're gonna burn. It's like lyrically, it makes sense. Tonally, it's a rock song playing in this. It could have had a synth wob words running out.
Yeah.
But I guess
that's a cliche as well.
Like we're really getting caught up.
Johnny Silverhand plays rock music.
Stylistically, it looks fucking great.
Yeah.
So title sequence great. Could use a better song.
I'll try it.
Beautiful. Excited to see what you think. All right. That is everything that we've been playing and watching. That was Splatoon 3, Middle-Earth Shadow of War, The Desolation of Mordor DLC, Wayward Strand, Little Orpheus, Dead Island, You Suck at Parking, and Cyberpunk Edgerunners on Netflix. We're going to take a short break. We'll be back with Game of Life Bread Talk after this.
Oh, gosh.
Skateboard! Oh, fuck. Oh, shit. Shit, I don't know how I'm gonna get home now.
We do literally everything on this island.
Actually, there's one thing you're not doing today. You're not carving up this delectable meal.
Slackers.
My broad axe, the perfect tool for chopping anything in twain.
I have the skull of Azeroth.
What the f*** are you gonna do with that?
Is it sharp?
I'll handle this with my cleaver.
What the f*** is this about?
What the hell is this game about?
What is this?
Why are you here?
It's meat.
Here I am on my beach.
Oh, what were you expecting?
Meat is good.
Look at that seagull.
Oh, I like that.
The narrator is the biggest cock blocker of all time.
I'd rather be playing Super Seducer.
Whoa, let's not say things we can't take back.
Meet Nathan Rohner, a mild-mannered game dev and VR enthusiast. But a freak jewel-severed foot accident has given him hot tub cars for feet and turned him into Roller Star. By day, Nathan must deal with the ever-crushing burden of being a brilliant indie game developer. But when the evil Dr. Pocket decides to steal all his money and not make his custom Patreon commercial for 6 months, you must use Rollerstar's flowing locks of customer loyalty to smack that pocket back into place.
Patreon? More like Patreon.
And after a hard day of crowdfunding injustice, Rollerstar sloshes into the pants of his lovers with his sexy dual jet hot tub feet. And when it comes to cruising for a feed, Rollerstar rolls right into the thick of it. Hungarian slop doesn't stand a chance with Rollerstar's high-powered hot tub boost leaping over the Central European cuisine with ease. And don't worry, kids, he washes up real good. Rollerstar! Rollerstar comes with everything you see here, plus everything you don't, including billions of hot tub-borne diseases.
Party, yeah, it's field party time. Party.
Oh, welcome back, and a big thank you to Lucas Horatio, Jerish, and Rollerstar there for words from our sponsors and just that sweet, sweet cash that we turned into commercials. Thank you. We also saw a play date, Stephanie, part two. Have you watched it yet?
Me?
Yeah.
Sorry, you were looking somewhere else.
I was looking at the lamp. Distance. I was talking to the lamp. Is the lamp being checking it out? Have you watched it yet?
No, I haven't.
I haven't watched
the things that I do.
Yeah, that's true. I haven't watched it properly. I have skipped through, but there's lots of delightful little moments. I remember that one being a fun one. Yeah. I'm so glad I'm doing it. So,
Will has said one of his favorite graphics in the last.
Well, the thing, it's not even graphic. I mean, it's not graphic.
Gag.
Yeah, it's an audio-based gag that I heard.
That's like Foley.
you'll find it when you watch it. It's.
Can you give us a clue?
Thomas the Tank. But there's no copyrighted stuff. We use the things that we use, but. It's train related.
At all. I don't remember any of it. Exactly. I don't remember any of it.
You know what I remember? Having a nice day.
We had a lovely day.
Really nice day, didn't we?
The game is like it's quite good. Like it's achieving what it sets out to achieve, but in an unexpected 100%. Way. 100%. I think. It's very funny.
Yeah, so we've got one more from that first set that we're doing, then we've got to do another record. So yeah, Patreon members have had early access for that since Tuesday?
Wednesday morning.
Wednesday morning, and then that becomes available for everyone to watch on Saturday, so everyone can check it out then. Thank you very much to all of the Patreon people who donated during the drive to make that possible. Let's move on now to a little segment we like to call... Sponsored by Nicrotex. I'm going to read on Nicrotex Twitter.
Yes.
A Twitter.
A Twitter.
Read him a Twitter.
That's like what boomers say.
Well, remember... Twitter. Remember...
I read a Twitter the other day.
Yeah, totally.
It had a bad word in it.
I've spoken about this, the Totally Red Show, which is the like web show that I'm re-watching at the moment from 2008, and Twitter had just launched and they were all joining it. Oh, wow. And they say sentences like, I Twittered this morning and then said what they were, and I was just like, wow.
Who is this 4chan?
Isn't it used to whistle at you?
No,
Twitter. When you
the notification
it?
Or
yeah, it's like a doo-doo. Yeah. I can't whistle.
Does it still do that?
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah. Nick Belling on Twitter.
Who?
Nick Belling, at Nick Belling, Nicrotex. 3 minutes into the Rings of Power. Okay, this idiot has no idea how science works. Which is a bold take.
Is it the brother? The older.
It's the brother talking about rocks.
Oh, rocks.
Yeah, rocks.
Water.
Yeah.
Oh, right.
But the rock pushes the water down or something. Yeah. And it's like, that's true.
It was fantasy.
An ancient fantasy elf race does not know about basic yeah. physics and flotation.
They don't have to. They got magic. Game of Life is, of course, where we bring something to help make your life better, a recommendation of another piece of media, a tip on how to do something in your life that might be difficult. Steph, do you want to start us off?
Sure. My Game of Life... My Game of Life piece of advice is inspired by someone in my chat last night, the night before, when I was streaming, who said that they'd just broken up with their partner and there were like tips for going to PAX alone. And at first I was like, oh, it's all about community and you can meet people there and you can just have a little time. But I think actually my piece of advice is like, do stuff by yourself. No. Which I know is contradictory to me always trying to play games with other people because I love social gaming, particularly at the moment. But in general, you know, I'm quite introverted and I really enjoy doing stuff by myself. I go to the movies by myself. I've been to concerts by myself. I've been to the theater by myself. And I think these are kind of things that people would never think to do by themselves because they might be embarrassed because it suggests that you don't,
so true.
You have no one in your life to go with you and there's going to be people judging you or something like that. But like no one is looking at you or cares about what you're doing or knows who you are. It's just like everyone is doing their own
thing. Not only at PAX, you're alone, you'll die alone.
Everyone is doing their own thing. So it's like,
let her get this out.
Brutal.
Or you cut them back down.
It is actually like a really wonderful, indulgent, self-celebratory thing to do is to do any of those things on your own.
Yeah. I legit think going to the cinema by yourself is the greatest fucking thing.
It's the best.
So, awesome.
So good.
I love it.
And I used to hate being in a movie in a cinema when it was basically empty because I took that as an indictment on my taste. But I love it now. Like my ideal cinema is no one else is in it.
Yeah.
I am there by myself in the middle. It's just like this is just a massive TV.
And a step above that is doing like Gold Class or Lux or something and having someone deliver shit to you in the middle. Love it.
I think I saw like the second Sex and the City movie on my own and I ordered like champagne and nachos. Like the person was delivering it and I was like, thank you.
But great choice. That movie's like 4.5 hours long. So, and also like getting the food delivered, it's like, oh, I'll take the salt and pepper squid and an ice cream sundae. You want those separately? No, in the same.
I can't mix them.
The salt and pepper squid.
You know when they're like, they have no room on the table and they're like, oh, you ordered so much stuff and they're just like, we'll make it work.
Totally. So I agree. Jokes aside, I've been to the movies by myself. I really enjoy it. I just don't do it that often, and I love it. I will say, like, theater and concert, that's a step up, and that's great.
I went to a Lady Gaga concert by myself.
Yeah, wow.
Because I didn't know any other Lady Gaga fans, and I was like, I am not missing this. And I went, like, right down to the front. I was, like, on the rail, and I was just there being like, woo!
I went to the theater in London by myself, and I will say that was great. There is, like, occasionally there's moments, and not just Gus moments where I'm, like, self-conscious, but, like, there is halftime where you get kicked out of your seat. And, like, sitting in a cinema, yes, it's easy to do alone, because you're in the dark, no one knows, you walk in and out, you're all good. Theatre, you come out and there's intermission, you're like, I'll get a drink, and I will get another drink, and, oh.
I wish you could be comfortable in your skin.
No, I am, but I would say being in an intermission alone at a theatre is trickier spot.
Why?
So I think... Because everyone is standing in little things and like...
You also don't have to leave your seat. You can like get up, stretch your legs, go to the bathroom if you need to.
What I'm saying is that I would like to be better at it. You are better at it. You are telling the advice you are giving.
I'm incredible at it.
Better at this. You're incredible at it. I envy that. I would like to as well. But there are some scenarios that are trickier than others.
I wish I was alone right now.
And I will
PAX might be one of those scenarios.
Yeah, I will say, like, I understand that PAX seems daunting because it is a big populated social environment. But I also think that, like, it's about your attitude. And if you go into it being like, how cool is it to be here, surrounded by all the things that I love and people enjoying the things that I love, and I'm just taking it all in. And
if you spot me with two flutes of champagne walking around back with
chalk tops overturned in them.
Yeah, yeah. And if you just think about it as just like, and there's no one to tell you what you can or can't do throughout the day or what you can't see
except
first
the cops.
Or whatever. It's just
nuts.
Like you doing what you want to do from start to finish.
Oh, and not having to do that. Where should we go next, guys? It's like, I'm going. I'm not going. They're like, do we want to do that? We want to do that. It's between three decisions.
Who is this person? Do you remember the name?
I do, but I don't know if I want to call them out.
Oh, I just figured it would be okay because they were on your stream. But no, that's okay. Okay, do you reckon they're watching now, potentially?
Potentially?
Okay, so I want to say man or woman?
Man.
Okay.
Sir,
because I think we could all give a piece of advice about this, but I will say, sir, If you come into PAX, if you come and find me, I will be your boyfriend for an hour. So around PAX, I will just be your boyfriend for an hour. We can walk around and hold hands. We can do some cutesy couple stuff, take some pictures, go see a panel, play a game together. I will accept over the shirt stuff.
Yeah.
Like first base, basically. But 1 hour, if you find me and Steph will tell me your name, and so you then need to tell me your Twitch name, and it needs to be the same, but I will be your boyfriend for 1 hour at PAX.
And I will park anywhere you want me to park.
And you know what? This is going to be so great because Nick will be really, really annoying, and it'll remind you of how great it is for you to be single at this time in your life because you've lost the dead weight of the relationship that didn't serve you, which is a point that Nick will drive home as he's hanging off your arm and asking you to go and see the anime thing for the fourth time because he loves anime so much.
But I'm a great rebound fuck as well.
I imagine the thing you're trying to say as well, which is great, is that the solution to being nervous about doing things alone is to do them, because not doing them is the opposite of that, which is very silly. But it's like, and just puts you further into that mindset and state of going, well, that was fine not doing it. I didn't go out. I didn't do whatever it was that made me nervous about it.
Yeah, I think it's just, I think it's doing it, but also it's reframing your attitude. If you think about it as an indulgent celebration of yourself, as opposed to like, I'm so awkward and I couldn't find anyone to do this thing with me, so I'm forced to do it on my own. It's like, it's a different, you experience it differently and it's actually nice.
Totally.
I have so many boyfriends in chat right now. This is insane.
I know. But as you were saying that, I was watching chat go nuts.
Yeah.
I was like, oh, Nick, you have opened a can.
Every hour of PAX now, you've got a little new boyfriend.
No, that's fine. I'm not doing the boyfriend experience with anyone except for the person that Steph tells me their name is. Gus.
Sure. I feel like I should clarify as well, because it was a good bit, but that time I went... I went and saw Book of Mormon by myself because I had 2 days by myself in
London. I thought you were about to say, my thing is like, I'm going to tell people how to poop in a tree.
No, I wanted to clarify that.
I know I'm talking about this a lot.
That was one of my moments that I was like, do I just do nothing in a hotel room for 2 days in London?
Yeah.
Or do I go and do things? And one of them was buy a single ticket to the theatre, which turned out to be like a third of the price of an
American. Yeah.
And I went and I was like, I dressed up. I had a few drinks in the hotel room. I was like, out I go. I went to the Royal Albert Theatre or whatever. And I sat around some other people. I think we were all like, we're all here by ourselves, aren't we? And I was like, this is fucking great. Had a drink, went to the bar at halftime. I was like, oh, this is a bit awkward, but have another drink and then just enjoy looking out the window. Went and saw the rest of the play, went home, put the soundtrack on, had a fucking lovely time. So, yes, it wasn't a full bit. I had a great time by myself embracing that. So,
yeah.
Good.
Next up, Lady Gaga.
Lady Gaga. My advice, or my game of life advice, is something I've just taken up recently and I hope it pays... I hope it's dividends. As fun, pays dividends emotionally, which is strike up a pen pal.
Oh!
No, not like that.
What and a twist!
There's more life.
What do you mean, not like that?
Any kind of pen pal is exciting because it's 2022 and no one has pens.
Exactly. So you know what you
do? I have pens.
You get a pen.
You send them a pen, which is what I did.
So who?
It's my niece.
Oh,
that doesn't
but
fucking
it's
count.
The second week in a row you're talking about having a relationship with a kid.
Jesus, Nick. Fuck.
It's not me saying it. Will, cue the tape.
He doesn't do that.
Okay.
I think this is a thing. I had a pen pal with someone else's kid because they were like, oh, they're doing a pen pal thing at school. They're doing a pen pal thing at school. And will you be her pen pal? And I was like, yes, absolutely. And I wrote her this amazing long letter. And then she wrote me a letter. And then I wrote her another letter. And then she never wrote back. And I was like, fuck you, kid.
You wrote that? No, okay. Letter writing is
abuse of the pen pal relationship. Yeah.
The main lesson or thing I'm getting into is letter writing. I'm doing it with my niece. But the big part about what I'm actually doing is the preparation, which is that I have bought all the stationery. I have bought all the little like trinkets and things that I'm going to send down, which is like you can go to Amazon and you can buy for $10 a bag of shit. It's like fidget spinners. It's the little like trinkets, all that kind of stuff. I have set a reminder in my calendar once a month to write that letter. I sent her some paper with a pen as well. And it's just establishing like a routine of something that I can do with a relative or a friend or something that's a routine that was really lovely to sit down. And again, I'm writing to a 4-year-old. So it's just nice to just enjoy.
How fucking good was that latest episode of Bluey?
Spot on. But it was like, I finished
it. Slaps.
Yeah. Honestly, the moment was folding it up, putting it in an envelope, like putting the stamps on that, and then walking down posting. I was like, that is as cathartic. That is a lovely feeling again. Like, it genuinely was rewarding.
And can I say, I'm sorry for making it weird.
Sure.
Because what you're doing is actually a beautiful thing. Mm. Because kids love getting mail almost more than anything on the planet.
Well, that's kind of thing, yeah.
And they love, love getting, like, the mortgage letter from NAB.
Yes.
So if you open up a letter addressed to them and the parents hate the cheap shit in there that's just going to break in 2 seconds, but the kids love it, and that is a beautiful thing.
Yeah, and it was one of those things. There's layers to this. I live in a different state from my family, so I wanted to establish a connection that's like, we'll continue on. It'll be something as a lovely memory. But it was just like, but doing it and having it all prepared was the other thing, because I don't want to be one of those people who sends this great letter and then like she writes back once and then no, we stop doing that. It's like,
yeah, totally.
No, I've got a box at home. I put everything in there. So when I have to do it or want to do it, it's like, I can sit down and do it, because I feel like letter writing is something that's romanticized as, oh, I should do it all the time. And then it's like, no, it's very easy to fall back into just, you know, text or, you know, family message threads, yeah, and that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. And I will try my best to keep it up. I hope it's something that I can.
How is it? What stage of the pen pal relationship are we in? Have you sent and not received?
Yes.
Oh,
the letter I sent
prepare
was like, dear Heidi,
your heart
I was like,
broken.
I was like, would you like to be my pen pal? And then I sent the piece of paper and a glitter pen to her
And was that the full letter? And I'm not being sarcastic.
No,
like,
no. I wrote lots of little things.
Yeah,
like,
okay, yep,
you know,
yep.
We did this and that, yep. You know, and then here's some photos of me
it's
and
so
your auntie.
Adorable.
And,
stickers.
Stickers are in there.
Stickers.
Literally the box I have is full of, Amazon, plastic crap, stickers, glow-in-the-dark stickers. I've got the... Is it Trolley? Is the brand of lollies?
Yeah, let's do the burgers.
Haribo, yeah.
It's like Haribo or Trolley. I bought a big bag of those that you can put one of them in an envelope as well. It's just like, again, it's to make it like a little package every time.
Mm. Yeah.
They like
adorable.
Huh?
That's adorable.
I thought you said they're terrible. They stink. Those things.
Oh, no, you should include a note at the bottom. Heidi, don't eat too many of these, or you'll shit yourself for a day.
Well, yeah,
that's just the sugar-free ones.
Just sent the one. But yeah, and then the idea is if she sends one back, and then I'll just keep sending them. And again, letter writing and connections with families. It's something that I think, you know, messaging all the devices have made us.
Yeah,
it's a nice thing.
I have my nieces on Facebook Messenger, and I send them messages every now and again, and they usually send me 2-word responses because kids don't really use phones in that way.
Cool. She'll phase out of the letters too. It's not going
to
last.
No, she probably won't. I reckon this is a really sweet thing to have with your uncle. This
totally.
Is like a beautiful thing that she'll probably do. Like if it's there, then it will do it at least until she's like 15 and then hates everyone.
Yeah. Without getting too deep, my uncle and auntie. My auntie did this for me and my sister all the time. Would send us these really fun letters and occasionally slip little funny things in there. And it was just like, we had that connection with her. And then I'm like, oh, I have an uncle too. I'm like, don't have any connection with him about that. And I'm like, it definitely built up something as a existing thing with a relative that has stayed there. And I'm like, I want that as well. So
that's nice.
I had a Japanese pen pal. We did a bunch of Japanese students came over to our school when I was sort of like, I think I was 12 or something, and billeted out to all the houses and stuff. And then they stayed for a week and a half and then went home. And one of the girls who came sort of like gave me a letter when she left, and they didn't really speak that much English, but she could write a little bit. And so gave me this letter and with the address. And so we started going back and forth. And then she sent me a letter like a couple of months later. And it was like saying how she had a crush on me. And she was like, oh, I really liked you. And I wish I could have stayed in Australia so we could be boyfriend and girlfriend.
Awesome.
And I had no modeling as to how to deal with kids liking me. And I was the most insecure, like, little kid ever. I cried when I read the letter. I then tore it up and flushed it down the toilet and never wrote back to her. Yeah, I'm a fucking monster because I did not know how to deal with that feeling.
Yeah,
it was so bad. There was a girl on my school bus that had a crush on me as well, and she sort of sat up the back, and I, as soon as
cut
I,
into
I
little
sat
pieces,
right at the front, I was like, I just don't know how to deal with this now.
Yeah.
I'm a much better human being now, but so don't do that to Heidi.
Yeah. No, well, no. What you're doing is you're training Heidi to be good at receiving and sending letters so that when she gets to that age where she's courting in high school, and she receives a letter from a boy or a girl or whoever.
She can decisively tear it up.
Yeah, she'll tear it up and be like, fuck you.
She'll get the letter and be like, where are the lollies and plastic?
Where are the lollies? Yeah. I want a little burger.
Is your niece Veruca Salt?
I want a little burger.
Yeah. She could be.
I love those. They're the perfect size snack.
So I bought them in bulk, and the smell permeates the plastic wrapping of each individual one and the bulk package. So I'm like, I'll put everything in this box and put it in a cupboard. I opened the cupboard. I was like, oh my God, it's just fake sugar smell everywhere. Yeah.
And
so,
now she'll associate that with you.
There you go.
That's adorable. Bajo's in here farting in the chat.
Oh, hey, buddy.
I think.
Peter. Look, mine's just about as deep as these two wonderful suggestions. It's a food take. But it's just a suggestion on a thing that we've only just discovered. They're very popular, but it's like they're pea crisps.
Oh, yeah. You're talking about harvest snaps.
I'm talking about harvest snaps. And I'm glad you said it because I only think of Natural Harvest, which is that book that we have.
Oh, no, that's bad.
Yeah. Harvest snaps. They're so cool. So it's like this pea mush that they then reform. It totally is. It's pea mush that they reform into a pea shape.
Yeah. I thought they just air dried the peas.
No. That's why it has that texture when you put it in your mouth and it kind of melts.
Yeah.
Because they've taken peas, mushed them, and then reconstituted them into the shape
of a pea. Yeah. It's fucking adorable. It's the coolest shit ever.
I thought I was eating real individual peas.
No, you're eating pea emulsion.
I guess it's like
with salt and vinegar sprinkled through.
You're
and
eating
then,
salt.
Yeah.
With a bit of pea in it.
It's been dressed
as like chicken nuggets. I have to say that the first time I tried harvest snaps, I was like, these taste pretty awful. Mm-hmm. But then I found the salt and vinegar ones, they are a game changer. And I know you love salt and vinegar, so I was like, we could try this as a healthy snack.
Yeah, the inami on those things is through the roof.
They're so good. Yeah. Very satisfying crunch.
Impossible to stop.
Also not
impossible to stop.
Well, that's the thing. They're not overly sickly that you then just gorge on them and go like, oh, I feel shit. Like,
And absolutely, without a doubt, the wettest crisp you've ever had.
Yeah. Wow. There's something that's like,
I don't know if the sponsorship gauge on this was like, hey, go. Steph's like, oh, what? And then it's like, wettest snack? Oh, we're back.
There's something about them that, like, it definitely absorbs moisture well.
Yeah.
So as soon as you open the bag, if there's any percentage humidity, they just go,
oh.
Well, it's also
your hands
because
at the bottom of the bag. It's just like, it's just green water at the bottom.
It's also because you're used to eating potato chips and anything that is a different consistency once you chew it. Feels weird because you're like, oh, this isn't what potatoes do. But
okay,
yeah,
they're great.
They're good. They're really good. And also, I tell myself that they're healthier, but I don't know that they are.
No, not in the volume that I consume them.
Because it's you can't leave a bag open.
And peas are still just starch, aren't they? Like
better catchphrase, not the wettest crisp you've ever had.
Cool, great one. Mine is a film. Will, do you have one?
I was going to say a TV show.
So okay, well, we'll do with you and I'll...
Yeah, yeah.
Did you say we'll deal with you?
No, we'll go to you. Yeah, yeah. It did come off as very
No, that's all good. No, I was just going to suggest, it's not a new show, but it all exists. It got cancelled, so it is one of those ones to go into knowing that they didn't get the ending they wanted, but a lovely comedy on Netflix, Kim's Convenience, which is about a Canadian-Korean family. Mr. Kim, the father, owns a convenience store. It's like, it's very hard to describe why it works so well, but I think one of the elements is that it was written to be a play. Like the pilot feels like a play.
Yeah.
It's even the dialogue, there's six seasons of it, even by like the third
six
season.
Six seasons?
Yeah.
But it
and they didn't
canceled.
Get the ending they wanted.
They didn't get the ending they wanted. It's family drama, as a lot of like comedy shows do it, but it's written in such a way that like, cuts to the course so often. There's so many moments that really just like hit hard.
I've not watched past, like, I watched maybe half of the first season and I didn't put it down because I wasn't interested anymore. I kind of just stopped because I sometimes do that. But great cast.
Yeah.
And you're totally right about that. Like it's quite theatrically blocked.
Yeah.
It feels like, it feels staged.
It feels like
in their set
at the start of every scene. It feels like lights have come up.
Yeah.
And the players are out.
Someone like comes in and puts a hat on a hook. Yeah. It'll be raining out there.
Yeah. I feel like you may have known this show. Do you remember The Good Life?
Yep.
Yeah. It's like that where it's like, like the sort of 80s British comedies where it's like, we just did all this in one take.
The young ones and stuff like that. Like it's a wonderful show. It's also just really good. I feel like for a lot of people, that it's a perspective that doesn't get seen very often. And because it is still like set in Canada, it's kind of in a world that we recognize. So it's getting a lot of culture and stuff like that. It's been wonderful. And it's been wonderful watching it with my parents as well, because different generations, you know, different views. And it's like, it just
gives a better perspective, and I
that's
think
awesome.
Yeah, nice.
It's really wonderful.
And chat saying that Simu Liu is in it, and I didn't recognize him when I watched it, and obviously Shang-Chi.
Shang-Chi, and he plays his job is at like a car rental place, and Simu Liu famously is like in stock images, and so yes, it's him is. Wearing like a buttoned up shirt in a place, and it's just like it looks like live action.
Amazing.
So yeah, well, it's all on Netflix.
Yeah, cool. Chat was also talking about Fresh Off the Boat as well, which is
I watched a bunch of Fresh Off the Boat.
Yes, in America, but
is that still going?
I don't know.
I think it had its run, and we were just watching it a bit later.
Did it get what happened to Fresh Off the Boat? Is it still going?
Can I just say?
You may.
I loved The Good Life growing up. It was so warm and
so
cozy,
charming and happy.
And the loveliest kind of.
It finished. Oh, okay.
Vibes. So good.
Yeah.
If you haven't seen The Good Life, and Ms. Muppet points out it was the 70s, not the 80s, totally right. Okay. It's about this couple who basically quit who live in London, who quit their jobs and decide to become self-sustaining. So they basically make a small farm in their backyard in the middle of London. And their next door neighbors.
Oh,
The next door neighbors are quite wealthy and prudish.
Hoity-toity.
Hoity-toity. And the husband is, the cast is phenomenal, but the husband next door is the Prime Minister from Yes, Prime Minister, which is just one of the greatest TV shows of all time. It is just, it is such a wholesome.
Just like, it's just that couple is so warm and.
They're so good.
Welcoming and fuzzy, and all the jumpers.
All the jumpers. All God, there's so many knitted jumpers.
It was I loved it.
Great show.
That's my game of life tip. Go watch The Good Life.
Yeah, totally. And mine is a film. Very rarely get to go to the movies. Did go to the movies and went and saw 3,000 Years of Longing. And so this is the new George Miller film of Mad Max and Happy
of IGN's Death Stranding, Hideo Kojima.
One of the finest pieces of
promotion.
Videography ever put on the internet.
Yep. The first, I think the first low-key job of all time.
One of his best interviews.
We're working as low-key for a bit, but it was definitely...
you're right. We've done a couple, yeah.
Sorry, not best of your best questions for the interviews that he loved.
And beautifully lit.
Beautifully written questions.
and the emailing back and forth with the producer with Sony was just top notch. So 3,000 Years of Longing. The idea.
Sick trailer.
Amazing trailer. Trailer? I think, Will, have you seen it?
Yeah, the film? Trailer, not the film.
Okay.
Yeah.
Has anyone here seen the film?
No. Okay, I didn't even know it was out.
Right.
Knew it was
so the film is, the trailer, I think, is one of those like amazing trailers, and the film is very good, but the trailer kind of missells a little bit as being more action-y and hyper.
Yep.
And kinetic again.
Yep.
But it is, but the basic premise is that Tilda Swinton plays a character who is, she's a sort of like mythology
scholar,
scholar something. And she finds a bottle when she's off on a work conference and in her hotel room opens it up and inside there is a gin. And that is, that's played by...
Like a genie gin.
Yep.
Yeah.
Not like
Idris
a
not a tonic.
Not a gin and tonic.
I've done that.
And then she just gets hammered over the course.
Yeah.
And so he offers her three wishes. And then the whole film basically plays out in the hotel room and then flashes back to the story of this gin throughout history.
Because even from the trailer, while it looked actiony, there was a part of it that looked like it was the play of him telling her his life.
It is one of my favorite kinds of films, which is someone weaving a fable. It reminded me of Big Fish, of that sort of like, how much of this do you trust? Mm-hmm. It's just this fanciful, beautiful story and going back. And it's beautifully made. There are some really wonderful visual ideas in it. I will say that the last act kind of comes out of nowhere and there are some character choices where you go like, oh, that's a very... immediate turn that suddenly happened here. And I did see a couple of reviews where I was like, it kind of felt like they just ran out of money. But I still think it's really worth going seeing because I particularly think that this is one of those movies where it's like, it's fantasy, but it's not Marvel. It's not based on this big existing IP. It's made for adults because it's a romance. It's about this djinn falling in love over the course of history. And it's just so many beautiful visual ideas in it and really,
really recommend seeing it.
I love that.
Original screenplay? Like it wasn't based off
I think so. I'm not
I
sure.
I assume so too, because it felt original from the trailer and such. But
yeah.
Does Miller ever not write his own shit?
Oh, that classic penguin tale, the dancing penguins.
Yeah.
Adapting the 1994 short story.
Okay.
That's yeah, but I really enjoyed it. It's not a perfect film, but it is the kind of thing where you like go see it at the movies.
Yeah.
The one thing about going and seeing the movies, when it's out at the movies, there is a moment where something happens in the film where a character is very worried about something happening and doesn't want that to occur. And as the, and I'm just being very vague here, but as the thing is about to happen, there is another character standing there to pick something up, and they pick the thing up and look up at the first character, and all the lights in the cinema along the walls explode, and the screen goes dark. And we're all sitting there going,
amazing.
Is that the end of the movie?
This was not supposed to happen.
And then it doesn't come back up. And we're like, what the fuck is going on? And we realize that the film has stopped. Someone walks in after like 4 minutes and is like, so we don't know what's happened. There is a bit of a problem, but we've paused. The film is paused. So once we get this system back, it'll just restart. We're like, cool. So we sit back, 10 minutes go by. Finally, movie comes back on. Opening titles.
But it's digital. They can go to where they need to.
Opening scene. About 5 minutes in, watching, and everyone's like, we were really enjoying this, but I don't know if we can all watch
this again. It is that consensus of someone do something.
Yeah,
someone
and it's like, something. What do we do?
The lights haven't come out enough.
And everyone was in there by themselves.
And no one was talking to anyone.
Yeah.
And so then someone runs out again. I was about to hop up and
wasn't
someone
beat
to it. No, I was going to. But then it goes off and gets a 16-year-old kid. 16-year-old comes in on the walkie-talkie and is like, so it's at the beginning of the movie. That's not where they're up to. And then you just hear through the walkie-talkie echoing through the cinema, okay, just get them to tell us where they're up to and we'll just get you there. And then we were like, okay, so it's kind of like, and I was like, it was the beginning of the third act. and that's like, that's not helpful. Like, it was about...
It's the character turn.
Yeah, 60 minutes in. And then we sit there and the magic of cinema is ruined because this film starts fast-forwarding in front of us and they're just skipping through and it's getting faster and faster.
To fuck her back!
And it literally is like, okay, we're getting close. We're getting close. And then we see the thing and everyone in the cinema, there's like 90 people in the cinema go, this is it! And then they don't hit it fast enough and we see the next scene and everyone goes, stop! it was very, very funny. But it really was like this incredible moment.
The way
like,
George Miller intended you to see it.
But I would
That's
love...
so funny.
But it did make me think. I would love if like someone was like, okay, so the end of this film is the lights explode on the side of every cinema. We'll pay for all the bulbs.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was very, very
funny. You want to go to DreamWorks 4D cinema and have your fucking leg slapped by a spider.
Yeah, I do. good. So that was go do more things by yourself. Get a pen pal.
Eat wet crisps. Watch Kim's Convenience.
And 3,000 Years of Longing.
Yeah. Can I get a short run? Because it sounds like it snuck out without really a lot of fanfare.
It really did. I didn't realize it was out. Yeah, like
I was really keen to see it, but haven't even heard like even like an Aussie premiere with George.
Yeah, totally. Like, yeah. But I think it's, like I said, I think it's definitely worth seeing. And I like supporting, I miss the 90s particularly. I had a lot of like adult films in terms of like films that were pitched at adults that weren't hyper-violent, but they were like...
No,
Eyes Wide Shut. Like, these are films about, you know, like, I'm thinking like 7 Years in Tibet. Or, you know, it's that sort of like this is an adult drama and they're just getting less of those.
Constant
and particularly at this like fantasy level as well.
Yeah. I hope, I wonder, it might be too hip to be playing at the Mount Vic Flick Cinema, but there is a movie theater in the Blue Mountains in Mount Victoria, which is like the very, pretty much the last town of the Blue Mountains before you start going down into the valley on the other side. And it's a converted old theater, like play theater. And when you go in there, you there's a stack of like
crocheted blankets that you can take one from to go and like cozy into your seat. And then there's a little window where they sell hot soup and bread where you can have hot soup.
Steph, I think you've gone to like a shelter.
You've walked into someone's house.
On movie night.
It's so like, nice.
That's
it's
very
so
cute. Nice.
Mount Vic Flix.
Mount Vic Flix, yeah.
Cool. All right. Well, that brings us to the end of the episode. Thank you so much, everyone, for watching. What a wild ride we've been on. We saw a bunch of games that we knew about mostly aimed at the Japanese audience.
Games from a few years ago.
Yep.
Now in Japan.
Yep. Good on that. We talked about all our games.
Which were new. Some were old as well. Some we just discovered were arcade.
Yep.
There you go.
And now in Japan. Yep. And then we did the thing that we just spoke about. But it means that we've come to the credits. So, Pete, cue me up.
All right,
my turn. Man. We all remember the disaster of last week.
I'm so sorry.
Are you ready?
Watch a professional do it. Back Pocket has a very special thanks to all our patrons. The mods, Gat, Syntax, Era, Kikarnage, Liz Dahlia, Sithcat, Phoenix Align, Disturb778, Jex, Caboose, and What the Shark. Oh, but the show would not be made possible without a pockety wrangler, and that is Miss Starlet. Little Miss Starlet, in fact. Gus Beard Wrangler is Dump Days. Department of Donuts is Honey Bun Bun, the Bot Lubricator. We Are Robots and Limbot. The Foot Severer is thanks to Moth Captain. The Foot Licker is It's Jep, who may be my boyfriend for an hour at PAX. Who knows? Costume Department is Oranishi. Remover of Foot from Gus's Mouth is Babbling Goffin?
Boffin.
Backbucket Legal Team, Akarash. Nick's own legal team for his dumb mouth is Burry Burry. Head Technician is Kane Lavos. Scotty Groomer, Glowing Might. Gaming Department is Empor18.
MPod
18. Naming Department is Oznaminator. Best Boy is Everay. Worst Boy is Evil Spy Boy. Boxy Boy is Boxy. Scotty Feeders are BT Nano and Super Studios. Scotty Breeders are Slowpunk and Zeke. Scotty Wranglers are Biferous and Snail XD. The Worm Wrangler is Toxichog, who I just learned is not going to be my boyfriend at PAX. He's not coming. You told me you would. We were going to kiss. Peter's Cable Boy is Wolsey. Well designed, thanks to A. Timothy. Gaffer, holder of Gaffer Tape, is BMAX. Steph's Attention Grabber is Daywalker 16. Assistant to Steph Ted to grab it when she loses attention is Daisy 86. Fire Starting Department is Ninja Pyru. Steam Refunder is Badge. Stunt Coordinator for Backflips is Reese Wild. Community Hot Boys and Aquatex and His Hot Boys of Coastal City and Avexia. Assistant Remover of Sugar from Coke is Kaylee Kool-Aid. Executive Show Cancer is Raj. Remover of Sass is Sassless, but the replacer of Sass is, of course, Skibberick. House Band is Muso for Hire and Middle C. Environmental Officer a Hungry Tree. Dinosaur Supervisor Phil Tibbet, God bless you. Bird Supervisor, Loki Cat, and Pocket Business Partner, Dream PC. Thank you very much to each and every single one of you. If you want to join the show as a member of our Patreon community, then head to Backpocket on Patreon, which is patreon.com/backpocket, or go to backpocket.gg, where there are links to everything that we do there, including, do we actually have any clocks for sale anymore?
They're always there.
They're always there?
They're always there. You can get a Nutchat clock.
You could buy a clock.
Or, you could get a pockety clock. Can you get a shit in your face clock?
You can shit in your face clock. It's not the name of that, friend.
All of these clock.
All of them as clocks.
You know what we should do? We should actually, this would be cool. We should buy a bunch of those clocks and put them just up on the walls.
Yeah, that'd look pretty cool.
That'd look pretty sick.
At different time zones. Like we're, we're the UN or something. And we're like, what's the time on Peanut Nut Chat?
But if they can't be clocks that make a ticking sound, though. That'd be very annoying.
Potentially.
What kind of clock do you think is making a
grandfather clock
ticking noise?
Are they not selling grandfather clocks?
Gus shitting himself at a grandfather clock?
They make enough of a little...
Yeah, I had a Mickey Mouse clock when I was a kid that I remember... It was his like gloved hand would go around, and it makes it ticking sound. Oh my god!
Music for Hire, take it away. beautiful. We've got the post show with Loki Cat coming up.
Oh,
Loki Cat. My goodness.
We made promises for post-show that I can never remember by the time we
did
get
near. We're going to watch the trailer?
Well, I have a thing as well. It's very silly, but I have a thing.
We're going to read something about... We're going to read...
The Cormac McCarthy... Cormac McCarthy?
We're going to read the fucking the car counselor sequence.
So I've had a look. I can't find it, but it is written by Cormac McCarthy.
There you go. Yes. That's
wild.
That's crazy.
Yeah. Wild. That's like Blood Meridian and The Road and... All the Pretty Horses. Nuts. So join us for the post-show. Thanks to Loki Cat. We'll be back again next week. Same time, but 10 minutes later because we're 10 minutes early this time. We'll see you then. Until then, we're backing it out.
Bye. Bye.